proposal. So that's how that, that's how that's gonna work. Okay, so the first, actually, Richard, you wanna tell us a little bit about your background?
Sure. I come from a varied background in probably both a 10-year period of economic development experience over a slightly longer period than that. And that was primarily in New York City, where I was working on a number of projects for Mayor Giuliani and Mayor Bloomberg. Lots of different, both large-scale developments and mixed-use developments, neighborhood rezoning and revitalization, and some interesting projects like the Yankee Stadium change and the Nets moving to Brooklyn. So I worked with the developers, with the community, with the neighborhood organizations, and there's a lot of those in New York, as well as the business community, folks that would be inhabiting the developments that were being built. I also spent about 5 years at a nonprofit that did thinking about urban economic development and in particular kind of retail development in downtown areas.
Okay, great. Tony, you're a townie.
Yeah, you're going to make me follow that. Basically, I've been a town for about 20 years, and I've been sitting in the audience for 20 years. I live down by Walker's Brook, so I went through the entire Walker's Brook Stage 1, Phase 2, Stop and Shop, Market Basket, Hallmark Health, all those developments around me, so I know where the audience and citizens are coming from.
Thanks. Okay.
So, you have the Meadowbrook Winterall.
Does that have to be read?
Yeah, I would read it and then just vote on it and make it official.
Okay. So, the applicant for the Meadowbrook Golf Course has requested to withdraw without prejudice. Says, Dear Mr. Chairman, this office has retained as legal counsel by Meadowbrook Golf Club regarding applications for site plan review and a special permit currently pending before your commission related to my client's property located at 292, aka 288 Grove Street in Reading. On behalf of my client, Meadowbrook Golf Club, I respectfully request to withdraw the application for site plan review and special permit without prejudice. So that's what they have requested. Can I get a motion?
Move that the CPDC accept the withdrawal of the Meadowbrook Golf Club proposal without prejudice.
Second. Any discussion? Anybody have a question? No? Okay. All in favor? Yeah. All right. So that opened up an hour here. About an hour. And we have a couple of things to discuss. So potential zoning bylaws amendments.
Remember to speak up.
Sir?
Remember to speak up.
I will. Okay. I think the first thing we want to take up here rather quickly is the accessory buildings or structures. Julie, do you want to summarize what we're doing here? Or what we were proposed to do?
So section 5.5, accessory buildings or structures, really mostly pertains to residential structures. But there's a section of it that mentions like any accessory structure that's within a side or rear yard setback needs to be no more than 12 feet in height. And the way that like now when applicants come in and they want to put an accessory structure in an industrial or business area, we apply that 12 foot height to that structure and it doesn't always necessarily make sense. So I think it was kind of an oversight that we didn't really address what happens with accessory structures in districts that are non-residential. So I proposed some language, but in looking to write this language, I noticed that most towns that I looked at regulate accessory uses, but not structures, non-residential accessory structures, kind of like what we had. Like, so it was hard for me to know, like, exactly how to write it, like, what makes the most sense. So I kind of just threw some ideas together.
And that's because 5514 says other accessory buildings or structures and doesn't say anything about just residential. And so the building inspector is applying that to industrial.
Yeah, and that first part, like part A, says just says accessory buildings or structures within required side yards or required rear yards shall be limited to one story or less than 12 feet in height. So it doesn't say it explicitly applies to just residential, which would then actually just leave a complete gaping hole for what to do with accessory structures in other districts. But then it maybe is like too restrictive.
But that's only within that required
yes,
rear yards.
Right.
So.
Right. So we don't, I mean, my initial fix here is like just for accessory structures that are within the side and rear yard setback, but which begs the question of whether we should talk about non-residential accessory structures that actually do meet setbacks, like if we need to have more full regulations about them. But I wanted to at least start the conversation and see where you guys stood on the issue before I like really delved into it.
Well, I always like to start with a map. So what happens if there's a this is industrial districts, not industrial uses.
Right, and we could add uses.
And my concern would be like a non-conforming industrial use
in a, yeah.
adjacent to a residential district.
Right.
Well, I noticed you're carefully saying residence district rather than residential.
Only because I noticed that was the way it was worded throughout the section, and there was like some areas where it said residential, and so I just changed it to make it consistent.
Okay.
I don't really care if you choose residence or residential. I think the word residence actually came from town council, so just went with that.
I don't think I've ever heard it referred to like that.
Yeah, I hadn't either until I read this more closely.
Well, I noticed it because the rest of the zoning bylaw uniformly says residential.
Yes.
5511 says residential.
Yeah.
You can change it back. I think that was a change that town council made when you guys updated this last time. So, because I never would have written it that way.
So how does this impact a non-conforming residential lot? How do they get accessory structures?
A non-conforming residential lot?
Well, all of the Green Street lots are non-conforming, right? Uses. Non-conforming uses?
Oh, non-conforming uses.
Yeah.
Well, so this talks about residence districts and then single or two-family dwellings and non-residence districts.
That's why I'm wondering if town council is trying to distinguish between a residential district or a district that has residences in it.
Mm. Okay.
That would be a nuance that isn't defined anywhere. I'm not saying he wasn't.
Interestingly, I should have looked before I opened my mouth. The existing bylaw, which is in effect, the table of uses has residential use, but it also says table of uses for residence districts.
Yeah, it's all over the place in the bylaw.
Yeah.
So I just like this paragraph called it out as residence, so I just changed everything in this paragraph to make it consistent. I don't know if that
town council probably has the right idea in this case. Because it's a residential use in a residence district.
Yeah.
So the use of the language is consistent. the but I'm not sure that we have explicitly regulated the accessory within non-residence districts. I mean, other than numbers and so forth.
We've regulated the uses, but we haven't really regulated the structures.
Right.
Okay. And like I mentioned, when I was trying to find guidance from other towns, I had a really hard time finding any town that regulates non-residential accessory structures. So.
Well, we regulate them. We regulate them that they have to be within the standards of the principal structure.
Well,
so
do we clearly say that anywhere, though?
Well, letter E does. And I think that, I don't have the whole thing either, but I thought that we had identified that elsewhere. So I guess what, I know what we were trying to do with 55514 was to provide more flexibility to residential uses in the case where, right, it all came up about sheds and garages, that, you know, that it that there are plenty of cases where it's not infringing on the neighbor to put a shed in that required side yard or rear setback. So I guess my question is, is there a reason to provide industrial uses that same
flexibility,
yeah, in those setbacks?
Well, what I thought was odd about that first, the 5511E, was that it sort of called out like a certain type of structure. It says non-residential accessory structures and then including vending machines, ATMs, electronic game kiosks. So I wasn't sure if it was meant to be more specific to those things.
I think the way that you rewrote it, it is. I think that originally it was, and because I think we did this, or not we, but this was done throughout the zoning code where examples were provided to make sure that those were covered, but not necessarily to point to say those were the specific instance, and then at some point those get interpreted as it's actually pointing to those, you know, to an ATM. But oftentimes it was just to emphasize, yes, ATMs fall under an accessory structure.
I mean, so I rewrote it that way so there wouldn't be a conflict with what I wrote below. But,
I'm happy to take it away, if
that was the intent. I thought it was a little odd that certain things were called out. But I get it.
Are you thinking you're going to try and get this into the November town meeting?
No.
Okay.
No,
April.
It's already closed.
Yeah. All
right. Yeah. Are there specific discussions, I don't want to get into a specific case, but are there discussions that you have had with folks that they aren't able to do something because of they want to do something in the side of the
right? So there's one specific instance which kind of brought this to light,
mm-hmm.
and then I thought, like, if we're talking about potentially like redeveloping down in the industrial area, it might be something that comes up mm-hmm. more. But I don't know if, like, Ed, if you want to say something, but it relates to Ed's property down on Ash Street. That was the sort of impetus for this.
Sure, do you want me to comment on it?
I'm wondering if the impact to you was more the height or the setback. The height was restricting it.
But it's because he's within, he doesn't meet the setback.
Right.
Okay.
So they're both.
Oh, yes.
Integrally related.
Okay.
us. We could figure out how to craft all this wording to make sure we're not.
Can I cover it? So it's industrial district fully or industrial district abutting a residential district?
So that's a conversation that you guys can have. But this was initially conceived as being just for the industrial district.
Well, specifically the non-residence districts, to me, which is more than just industrial.
Well, so I just actually talked about industrial district, and then I put a note whether we would want to include business districts and try to craft some language for that as well. I didn't know if that was opening up like a bigger can of worms, because we have various business districts, and a lot of those actually have a lot of residential abutters. So I didn't know if we want to do it all at once, or just take a piece now and give the business districts more consideration.
But the setbacks you're looking at currently for business A are 15 feet from the front, 10 for the side, and 20 for the rear, correct? And then business B is just 20 in the rear.
What is it in industrial, since you have it up there?
In industrial, it's 50 in the front, 20 on the side, and 20 in the back.
Say 50, 5-0?
5-0.
Yes. That's a required front yard.
Oh, so that was left over from before we changed that elsewhere. Because it used to be 50 for business.
It still is, actually.
No, 20.
I'm looking at...
Say 15, 1-5.
It depends on what you want to build, if you look at the table. So for hotels and motels, it's 15, doesn't it say? It looks like for industrial, it's consistently 50.
Should address it and just figure out what these words mean, residence versus residential, if there is any impact to that.
On the second look, I don't think there is an impact. I think it's the, as written, it's correct.
So you think they're just interchangeable?
No. I think the bylaw is written to use residence district, residential use.
Yes.
I guess there's a reason why we have setbacks, and whether it's a principal structure or an accessory structure, it's the same impact to the abutter. So I guess my take on this is are the setbacks the right thing? When those industrial districts aren't abutting but another district, residential or commercial.
I'm not sure.
You know, we have those different setbacks and requirements for commercial districts that abut residential districts,
right?
Because of that interplay between the two. I guess if you're talking about an abutter to another industrial parcel, I think that's a different consideration than if you're abutting some other type of use.
Okay.
But I don't know why we would consider different heights within the residential district. I mean, within the industrial district. I mean, it's sort of, there are specific cases where we're doing that in the residential district. I don't even understand. I can't imagine what that is that wouldn't have that
a big effect.
What is it you're saying, John?
Why are we, why, if we want to allow it, accessory building 30 feet in height, well, why wouldn't we just change the setback if that's really what we want to allow? Because I don't, if I'm in a butter, I don't care whether it's a principal building or an accessory building. That's still a big building staring me in the face. The whole reason why we looked at allowing accessory structures in setbacks was because I think that it's generally sort of understood and agreed in the residential districts that you can put garages and sheds in that, and it's really not going to change the character, and really, like, people do it anyways. It's not changing that character, but if there's something more substantial, then we should be looking at it more holistically, not just how do we look at those accessory structures in that area.
So you're saying change the setbacks for principal structures as well?
I'm saying we ought to be thinking about that. I'm not if it's not right, it's not right.
Okay.
You know, if it's right, it's right. That's my take.
I think if it's a budding or residence district, then you either get the setback or you get the height. Right, so if the accessory structure is allowed to be within the setback, then there should be the height limit. That's the impact.
Because we allow principal structures in industrial districts to be like 60 feet tall, so I feel like there is a difference whether you have a 60 foot building like 5 feet from the property line or a 30 foot building 5 feet. I mean, maybe that's not a good example because the person experiences the 30 feet,
right.
But you know, like on a smaller scale, I feel like there would be a difference.
I think industrial to industrial is one thing, industrial abutting the others is a different concern.
Yeah, but I'm thinking about it, I think that the regulating or varying the height based on the abutting district is reasonable. And we are restricting it to the side and rear yards only. And so they can't encroach on the front setback, according to the current law.
You can't have the accessory structure in the front.
Yeah, setback. We don't allow it.
Right,
because we want the principal structure to be the dominant structure.
Right.
Does 50 feet make sense in the industrial district?
Well, the building height is, or when the front yard is 50 feet, the building height is 60 feet.
Yeah, I mean, 50 is a lot. It just constrains these lots even more.
Right.
And they're not necessarily abutting anything that.
Well, that's why
right.
I think we need to
makes
use a
it
map.
Matter.
We need to do this with a map and see where these things are.
Okay.
And can you allow different setbacks at different heights?
Yeah, you guys could do anything.
What?
You could have it step back if you had to. Step back.
I mean, the whole reason why, right, it was done incrementally back in the 80s, when things were still car focused, right, we had 50 foot setbacks on pretty much everything in town. That got changed just for the thing that was the most obvious, which was, you know, South Main Street, and I guess at the time we didn't bother with the industrial district. But on the same, I mean, because we never had that conversation.
It was also a non-issue. I mean,
right.
Because our only industrial district is Walker's Brook, if you will, which enforces
the setback.
Substantial setback and so forth. So geographically, it didn't make any.
It was
unnecessary.
Yeah.
Right.
But if we're looking at all these, we
reconsider
that.
So do a more holistic
approach
to this, rather than like a piecemeal, quick fix kind of thing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Sounds Sounds good.
Okay.
You guys want to look at other priorities for 2018?
Yeah, let's look at that priority, zoning priority list. This last
enough?
Presented?
It's been a while. I think it was before November 2016 town meeting, like sometime that summer.
Before we had all of those zoning changes in that couple
yeah.
town meetings we had.
Yeah, because I added the column for November 2016 and April 2017, and then the future priorities I updated.
Okay.
And I took away a 2013 column because there just wasn't room.
Sure. Well, as you can see, what we have at the top here is this sub-district guidelines, which have been brought to light with the recent projects and probably should be addressed first anyways. If we're going to put an effort into some zoning, that might be what we want to do. I guess that's what I think. Mm-hmm. What I think we would do is just get schedule a couple of planning sessions where we solicit all the concerns and ideas and then take all of that and bring those to a workshop where they can be worked on in detail. We would do some pre-work on whatever the ideas are, find other examples, other information we'd want to put into that, and then we'd have that to discuss and work out. That's what I was thinking, but I don't know what you guys are thinking about that.
Sounds good.
Yeah.
Sounds good.
So when would you be targeting town meeting on that one?
Okay, well, I thought that I guess the only thing that has to go to town meeting would be the sub-district. But the standards do not.
No.
We can implement those any time. So do we actually have to have a sub-district? Is that part of the zoning map, or is that part of the zoning? Is that part of the guideline?
It probably would need to be on the zoning map, I would think.
So.
But I can look into 4ER and see what the specifics are.
So what happens is zoning has to be written up and then get approved through a public process, and then it goes to town meeting to get voted on. The standards are separate from the zoning so that we can update them without having to go through the town meeting process. It's a little less tedious. You know, if something comes up, it's like, oh, this should be like this, then we can correct it. It's still a public process. It's just that it doesn't have to go to town meeting. But I still think, all right, so let's check and see what the process is, whether it has to go to town meeting. We could still write them or get them going and potentially list out where these guidelines apply, and then we could apply them.
Well,
if we don't call it a sub-district, you know, we could say Wolf Street is this, and Green Street is that, and Hatch Street is this.
Well, could you put, instead of developing specific sub-districts on a map with borders, could you put more like, I'm going to say more of like a performance standard in where if these certain conditions exist, then this guideline applies.
I'd be willing to look at that. As long as there isn't something specifically in 40R that says we can't do something.
That's a good idea.
Yeah.
Like an if then.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't remember.
Especially if the downtown is would be like consistently changing, you know, like, or continuously changing. Like, okay.
I don't remember. We had to go through DHCD for the design guidelines. Yeah. So we do have to get the state approval.
Right.
And that probably applies to changes as well as the districts, if you will.
Is there a limit on sub-districts? I thought there was.
I don't know. I'll have to look.
I thought there was a limit of 2 sub-districts. Check on that too.
Mm-hmm.
public comments on that particular process? Do you have any questions on that process?
What is a sub-district?
So right now, there is an overlay district in the downtown that has the 40, that allows 40R, this zoning option that somebody could take and do a mixed-use development. Right now, the downtown is zoned for business, and there is an overlay district for this 40R. But it's just one district without separating out what might be happening in any particular location. It's all the same rules. And our ability to approve variances, if you will, or to ask for more or less of something, lets us craft the project as it gets to some specific neighborhood.
Not variances. Waivers.
Waivers. Granting waivers. Having a sub-district would say this area has these guidelines and the regular 40R has these guidelines, and so you can get really specific as to what's happening in any particular neighborhood, you know, and write something that brings the scale down or has a different architecture to it or a different mix. Oh, let me just follow up on that.
But this is going to happen in every neighborhood that this touches in the future.
40R?
Yeah.
Where
it all abuts residential neighborhoods, we're going to have the same problem.
Well, it's over the entire neighborhood. So it's not, I'm trying to think of which residential district it's abutting. I guess it would be on the Lincoln Street side. And there are rules for that already.
Right.
So where this district abuts a residential district, and remember, this is the confusion that we had a little bit earlier. You're not in a residential district. You are a
residential.
You're a business page. Yeah, but it's residential uses. In there. And so you're within the whole district. We would write rules for within that district. When you start touching other districts, then you have consideration for what does that neighborhood look like and what should you be doing there. And we address some of that in our guidelines. I don't know if you've looked at them, actually, but we talk about how, you know, specifically what the setbacks are and what the angle of the viewing angle is from the building face, so the building has to continue to step back so that you know. So we did address some of those things as we abut residence districts.
I get that, but, and I don't agree with that angle, personally, but... on Main Street, where Sunoco gas station is, that's in the 40R, correct?
Yes.
Yes.
So there's a residential, you have the Sunoco gas station, then you have a residential.
Yes.
So we're going to have the same problem as we're having with Green, Gould, and Ash when something happens down there.
It's just
as part of this whole process, you know, my main emphasis is where I'm at, but to try to eliminate this, you know, going down the road for everyone else.
There's probably, I'm going to say, 12 commercial properties in town that do not abut a residential district. Our entire commercial zoning district abuts residential, and that's so every for the past 12 I don't even know how long I've been on this board 10-12 years, every just about every development that comes in, that's 90% of what we try to address is how that impacts the abutting residential district, because that's what we have here in Reading is commercial district and the next property over is residential. So all the, you know, everything that we would do, whether it's, you know, these design guidelines or whatever kind of sub-district guidelines, it has to address that interface, because we have it. It's so pervasive in our
It's not just 40R.
Just not 40R.
Restaurants on South Main Street behind them are residential properties, and we've addressed their concerns specifically.
So would you agree that our neighborhood is a very specific and special case in this scenario, since most of your commercial stuff doesn't apply, like you said, residential? I mean, you know, and if we do become a sub-district, is this something you're actually considering? And, you know, could you give the neighbors a waiver or a variance from that, and, you know, give us those setbacks in our just our little sub-district, since we weren't supposed to be part of 40 yards to begin with?
To begin with what?
Well, you said this at the last meeting that a year ago we were assured we weren't part of the 40 yard during those meetings, those abutters meetings, and then in January you had your meeting with the selectmen's office, and watched it now a bunch of times. And you guys had a similar conversation about including the 40R, and it was a really positive conversation where it was like, you know, this is a great thing, maybe we should add them in. And it was so positive and like effective that nobody was really thinking about what it would do if something like this went into the middle of our neighborhood. John Halsey said, this is going to be a win-win for everybody. Maybe 7 or 8 of them could sell their homes as a bundle to a developer, and he could rip them down and build a 40-something. And there were a lot of references to a New York neighborhood, brownstones, and someone else said, like, put your bulldozers away, you can't bulldoze the whole town. Just there was a lot of conversation. It was all positive. There was no negative, but there were no abutters at the meeting because we weren't notified that you guys, like, it wasn't a abutters thing. We were already kind of aware of the fact that 40R was going to be in that triangle, and then we were added in, and then you guys said, okay, time is of the essence, I think it was. I have always become an avid binge watcher of town meetings, and I draw all the characters, and I can't, it's a lot. I don't know how you do what you do. I couldn't do it all the time. But either way, were you talking about these things to change the zoning for us in this particular case, or going forward to others?
Well, I don't think they'd be in place for this one. But we're still addressing a lot of those concerns with this particular project. And a lot of the things that come out of this one might be in design guidelines, design standards.
But no one's going to rip down their houses. These are all historic houses that were built.
If you've watched every meeting, I've always said there's no way that all of these properties would fall at once. It just won't happen because someone doesn't want to sell their house, they want to live there.
Right, no.
So it's not going to be, clear out the whole downtown and just build something completely different.
Right, but, you have that, and you have that momentum, and you have a group of people who are all thinking the good of it all. I mean, that was a comment, that was a crazy comment, I thought. She ripped down 67 houses in a row, and then whose house there, like the little guy in the movie Up. We can't rip down, we have to refurbish and restore instead of ripping down and rebuilding.
Yeah,
our guidelines, our bylaws have to reflect that.
Yeah. Was anything even like that done in New York, where you're taking down entire
neighborhoods?
No. There's value in there, and there's people who are committed to living in there. So that's a very unique neighborhood. It's got, a different scale. It's got some historic buildings to it, and it's in a downtown district, which is susceptible to, more traffic, and I don't mean traffic by car traffic, I just mean like people. There's activity down there, there should be. It's the appropriate place for that use. So there's a lot of different things happening along those edges, and I think we just have to address them.
Hmm.
I think as a whole, I'm not an abutter. I live elsewhere in the town. I've been in the town for almost 24 years. And I'm very concerned.
Sorry, could I have your name?
Lucia Corbett.
Thank you.
And I'm very concerned about the changing landscape of our town. It used to be, it should be a charming little town, and that particular area looks like it's being overrun by enormous developments.
and I don't think it's appropriate. I think we should be limiting height on these buildings and how much of a footprint they're taking over. It's going with the hodgepodge.
Okay.
And it really should.
Yeah, I'm going to express the unpopular but reality situation is that it is zoned business. Now, we didn't do that. It's town meeting. Because it is zoned business, if you own a house, a property in that area, you can't sell it to somebody and have them tear down the house and make a better house. It's not allowed. You can't rebuild or improve except within the scope of a non-conforming use, pre-existing non-conforming use. The same thing is true all the way down South Main Street with business A on the curb, if you will. 50 feet back, there's a transition from the business A to the residence district. So the opportunity for somebody to come in and redevelop the property, they can't redevelop it as a house, as a residence, because that's not part of the zoning. And the 40R is a way to, in principle, enhance your property value, because it'd be more opportunity for somebody to purchase it from you and do something else with the property. And the state law gave us the opportunity to put in design guidelines, more constraints, and to do what we could to control that. But the fact of the matter is, you can't sell your property and have somebody build a new house on it. That's not the district that it's in. So
I understand what you're saying, but that's not really what I'm saying. I'm not saying that we should be putting houses where the post office is, or where the Atlantic used to be, or where the E-Mark building is. I'm just saying these enormous replacement structures shouldn't be going there.
Okay.
I mean, it's fine if it's a mixed-use building, but why does it have to be so huge?
Okay, well, that gets back to really what I was trying to get at was a process for coming up with design guidelines. So we're going to focus some priorities on it and developing these guidelines as part of it. And I know you've made several presentations, and some of the information is good, some of it's misinformation, which has to be corrected. But I'd want to gather that kind of stuff at these planning sessions. It'd be more like a meeting like this. You'd get them all bulleted. Let me do some research and come back for a workshop, probably in a different space where we could lay things out and develop the actual guidelines there. Understand, too, that we really are limited to this open meeting process. We can't talk behind the scenes, and so things get done in two-hour stints. It's not something that gets done overnight, unfortunately. It takes a while for all of us to meet and come up with information, have public hearings that are noticed, get all that information. And these guys work incredible amount of hours, making that data mean something. So that's what we're looking at doing.
We just want to be included in the process.
All the meetings are publicly
notified.
I mean, we notice all the meetings. They're all up there. And you guys are in Precinct 5, I think. I'm sure.
Yes.
I think there's open seats on that. I don't know why those seats aren't filled for town meeting. This seat sat open for 2 years, plus Julie Hall, you've been here, that seat's been open.
2 years.
There's always a need for people to get involved before the stuff gets to your neighborhood. That's how we do it.
We welcome it, because now that you've watched all these, how many times we sit in this room and there's not a single person, or maybe one person in the audience, and we don't have that dialogue. We just have the dialogue among ourselves. So the more, the better discussion and more viewpoints, and we want that.
Right, and I am involved when I get a notice that says I'm in a butter, and I didn't know there were any open seats on a town meeting. Or?
I want to say there are. There are 24 seats per district. Is that
yes.
What it is? And I thought I only counted 22 names. When's the town meeting? November.
Starts on the 13th.
So usually there's a precinct meeting before that, and you can fill an open seat just by getting the people in the room to say, okay.
And if you want to know about upcoming CBDC meetings, the best way to get our agendas is to actually go on the town website and e-subscribe to CBDC agendas, and then every time one gets posted, you'll get an email about it, because certain things you won't necessarily get a notice about in the mail. But you can know everything they're discussing by subscribing to their agendas.
Thank you.
I mean, would Green Seat have been noticed on the postmark? Is that within the limits of that?
I don't know. I'd have to look.
Yeah,
it might be just outside of it.
Okay.
I wanted to just make sure that you guys had said the same thing to each other in terms of, you had said that 90% of the commercial properties abut residential in this town, that there was 12 to go, and I just want to make sure. I feel like you might have said the opposite, right? So that's what I just wanted to make sure. So he's saying that there's only 12 properties, commercial properties in town that don't.
Okay, I'm sorry, I did misunderstand.
Oh yeah, 12, by the way.
It's a guesstimate.
If you look right, if you think about it, if you look at every, just about every commercial business. If you peek over the fence, usually you're looking at the backyard of a residence, like yours. But pretty much, you know, most commercial districts, commercial businesses in town,
so
that's the case.
So then you will run into this then with
yes, yeah, that's, yeah, which was my point. This happens.
We run into it with 40R, we run into it with every other zoning section as well.
Yeah.
I mean, it isn't.
But 40R allows apartments to be built, whereas the business didn't allow a transition from apartments to residences. Is that correct?
The business district in downtown,
yeah,
does not business. Allow residential, correct?
Right, but when you put 40R in it, it makes it so that it can be a hybrid. It can go from business to residential.
It has to be both.
Oh, it has to be both.
You could do a smaller only residential project.
That would be nice.
Well, listen, the Business B, someone could come in and build.
My point is, it allows you to switch from business to residential.
Mixed.
No, it's mixed.
It's a mixed use.
No, it doesn't allow you to switch the district. It allows you to do a use.
That's what I mean, use.
Yeah, but it's.
Switch the use.
The residential, I mean, there is a multifamily residential, which is, I believe, allowed in the 40R.
Yeah.
Without the commercial, the mixed use, but it's more constrained.
You can't blow up as high,
right?
What was that comment? I'm sorry, Jane.
You can't go as high if it's all residential. The height limit is
33.
If it's mixed, it's 45.
Wouldn't it be ideal to have it just residential being under house?
Well, I think that there's some drive to keep the downtown as an active commercial area to
have
businesses.
We have openings, the butcher shop, Zynga, you know, like we have places. I don't want to reiterate and go into what we've been begging you for a couple of months.
Okay.
Why is Green Street, why is that neighborhood, which has been a residential neighborhood since it began, in a Business B?
Well, that was well before.
Back into the 50s or something.
Many of the residential uses in the downtown area existed prior to the town's adoption of zoning. So, I mean, I don't know what happened in 1942 when the districts were drawn, but.
But obviously it was zoned incorrectly because
listen, that neighborhood historically, and if we look at some of the stuff, has always sort of been intertwined with what was happening commercially in that downtown. And it wasn't just little single-story colonials, there were some pretty large buildings anchoring the corners of this neighborhood. I mean, the Blackburn building is gigantic, the Doucette building is large, the MF Charles building, which is probably the best building in town.
Correct.
It's a large building, although I don't think it's imposing. And everything across the street from Haven on Main Street was about the same size, where Christopher's is right now, there were several buildings right up to the gas station that was there that were about the same height, you know, that 45-foot height. So the neighborhood has always sort of lived within what was happening in downtown, and that was commercial stuff and residential stuff, a little village.
But why wouldn't they zone it like it was built at the time you talked?
And honestly, that happened when the zoning was created in Reading, and like everywhere else in New England, and well, I'll leave it to New England, there were lots of zones that were created that didn't fit what was actually built. I mean, there's whole, you know, neighborhoods here that have non-conforming structures on them because the lots are too small and all sorts of things like that. So it's not that your neighborhood isn't singled out, nor is Reading odd in that way that we have pre-existing
non-conforming uses.
It was back in the 40s and 50s that was what was done, and I can't tell you why because I didn't exist back then.
Well, 50s you probably existed.
No.
No.
I'm old.
Okay. What other? Could we take anything else on if we're doing that?
Seems pretty. The second one up from the bottom, the updating the subdivision regulations. I've had a preliminary meeting with the town engineer and the conservation administrator about kind of setting up sort of a working group for 2018 to look at that. So that, and that might be something, that's another thing that wouldn't have to go to town meeting since it's regulations. But that might be something that I would want one of you guys to help out with, one or more.
Okay, so we get that started and then just let it go at its pace for a little while?
Yeah, I mean, it seems like it's ripe, but it's not like necessarily as urgent as, I would say, the sub-district design guidelines. Because you kind of have a good hold of that process, you know, a good handle on that process.
But they're going to come in on a regular basis, these four to...
Yep.
Like four lot subdivisions on cul-de-sacs, and we see them constantly. So,
yeah.
I mean, it's not a flurry, but
right.
It's
yeah.
Constant.
I mean, so this is a priority. I was just putting it maybe second.
I agree.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that would be okay.
I'd make a plug for downtown parking.
Yeah. Let's get started.
Parking requirements / downtown parking. I know we've talked about it a little bit.
Well, it's curious that the people have been doing the parking utilization studies, and the answer that has been coming back is that it's nowhere near as much of a problem as it feels. I mean, yes, if we had more parking spots at the train station, more people would park there. But that's about the entirety of the downtown parking problem with the current development. I mean, it's going to change with the Postmark Square and some of the other things, Reading Village, if those things ever come to completion. But for now, the analysis says there isn't really an issue.
No, the analysis says there isn't a shortage of parking. The issue is that it's the way it's used, right?
Yeah.
It's underutilized, it's in the wrong places,
okay.
And so there's still an issue. The issue is getting people to use it the right way and find. But right now,
Okay. Everyone
sees they want to use this spot. This spot's always full, and so they don't realize that there are 10 spots somewhere else. Or they're not really convenient for that particular use.
Right.
Yeah.
It's
okay.
Management and signage and
right.
sharing and...
So could we approach that, I'm going to say, much like the sign bylaw rewrite was done, in that it's not really It's not necessarily this board entirely, but some help from economic development folks, or maybe some other resources in town that can look at how parking's actually used and what the demand is and that sort of thing. Because I think it's bigger than just the sort of the physical inventory.
We could start by collecting all the data. We have done several reports, so some, a lot of stuff out there we should probably get and see what needs to be updated.
The issue here is bandwidth.
Always.
The answer is to build a multimodal transportation hub over in the industrial district with a parking garage, which frees up 200 parking spaces in the downtown.
There's the issue there.
Station.
Yeah, funding.
Mm-hmm. No, well, the MBTA would have built that.
Oh, yeah.
That the issue there would be the same time frame.
Well, we could zone that area to be some sort of, medical tech kind of free zone. Dubai. Mm-hmm. But over there in industrial.
Oh, yeah.
I think we're at 8:30, so
let's
move on to this next part. So stay tuned to all of those CPDC notices, please. All right, we have a continued public hearing for the 4-year plan review 2024 Blue Street.
With DCI traffic engineer on the project here to present part of our presentation tonight and then also follow up with questions. In terms of the agenda, we're going to go through the latest plans and modifications, renderings, the traffic study, talk about parking counts, and then get right into Q&A. I just want to say I recognize that this project, just being listening in a little bit in the previous hour, this project has brought up a lot of, awareness of smart growth and strong feelings. And I hope that, we appreciate the feedback. I hope that comes across, that we appreciate the feedback that we've gotten from you all. We started with you at the Butters. And we certainly think that as in this process, it's gotten better. So we absolutely thank you for that. And we also have updates to share tonight, which we think have been further responsive to the comments that we've heard. And we've really not stopped trying to be as responsive and solve problems as we can. And so hopefully they're going to come.
Do you want me to hand those off?
So we have here, these are the parking memos,
okay.
And then we have plans as well if you want to.
Okay.
We can.
What about the small ones? Do you have small plans for them?
We do have small plans. 11, 17. Not that one. So this, we'll have all the plans up here. We also have boards tonight, just to be able to look at everything simultaneously. I thought that might be helpful. And sometimes it's easier to see things on boards. So whenever you're ready, Julie, we can jump.
All right, I just
want to
make sure that I can follow along. Each staff is different.
Okay.
So we talked, next slide, then next slide. So a couple of changes that, again, this is just for those who are now very familiar with the building. This is along Gold Street right here. We have our neighbors here, our Green Street neighbors here, and our fellow Gold Street commercial neighbor here. Things that we've changed. First of all, there's the 3-foot setback all the way along here. And then we basically looked wherever we could basically to pull in that setback. And so we pulled that in to a 7-foot setback from here on. And the way we're able to do that was basically you could see that the parcel is skinnier here, wider here. So we were able to sort of tuck everything up and extend this setback from 3 feet to 7 feet along the Green Street side. We're going to be getting to everything you see in front of you on the presentation. So that's one of the big changes that we've made. You'll see that what we submitted this morning was we pulled, basically this used to be parallel parking right here, and now we've made it head-in parking. And this has 65 spaces. I'll be honest, we were working on this today to try and figure out how we could further maximize the parking. And if you click to the next slide, Julie, what we did here, this shows 69 spaces. And what you'll see is basically we've this extension right here was pulled in. We were able to move the elevator core and the stair core, actually work nicely with the lobby. We were able to get 69 spaces within the garage, which gets us to a 1.25 in the garage for 55 units, which I'll talk about in a second. So again, just to recap real quickly, 3-foot setback to a 7-foot setback. We now have 69 spaces in the garage and very similar sort of setbacks along Gould Street. We still have the 5 angled spaces along Gould Street. For short-term pickups and deliveries, supporting both the residential and the retail. And that 1.25 doesn't include those angled spots. So we go to the next slide. Other major change, we pulled the entire floors 2 through 4 back off of the rear property line by at least 15 feet. We just basically took a straight line from our property line, 15 feet, drove back, and our building on floors 2 through 4 doesn't extend beyond that 15-foot setback line.
And no balconies.
No balconies as well. We have 55 units, 29 one-bedrooms, 21 two-bedrooms, and 6 three-bedrooms. So we've also reduced the unit count from 58 to 55. I think when we started this process, we were at 64, I believe. So we've reduced those quite a bit in order to manage these setbacks and based on the feedback that we've heard. So moving on to the next, you'll just see basically that these changes telegraph up through the 4 floors in terms of the 15-foot setback. And we still have the same articulation of the facade along Gould Street. And really, that's the summary of the changes in terms of the floor plans and setbacks. So if we'll go to the next page. So we were asked and tried to do our best in terms of putting together sort of the details of this in a more clear format. And so here, I'm just going to walk you through some perspective renderings that we have. So here, basically, you'll see 24 Gould Street, the outline of the building. This is the outline of the parking. And we have the upper building, as I just talked about, line. This is 15 feet back from our property line. Okay, and you'll see that the ground floor has the 3-foot setback and then the 7-foot setback, as we just talked about. And in comparison, just to where our Green Street neighbors are, in terms of just where the 15-foot setback is in relationship to the properties that are there. You can see But it varies, as you would expect in a neighborhood that's been built up over time. So we go to the next slide. So this just basically shows the condition in section for 26 Green Street. And so basically, you got top of the ridgeline plus or minus 30 feet. You got a 14 foot plus or minus setback. You do have some decks and some egress within that setback. And then you'll see in terms of the building at 24 Gould
David,
Street.
David, yep. You want to present it from this side?
Is that
so you're not
better?
Blocking the street.
Yep. So 24 Gould Street, basically you see the parking floor, and then you see the residential floors above. Again, you see that 15-foot setback, you see that 3 to 7 foot varies, you see there's no access by any resident closer than 15 feet, there's no rear balconies, and this 60-foot is the distance, you know, this is the courtyard, basically, and this is the distance to the section of the building that fronts along Gould Street. Okay, and again, we have these on board, so we can pull them out and take a look at them in more detail. So can we go to the next one? Just some perspectives. Current perspective, 16-foot plus or minus, it varies in different locations. And see 26 Green Street here. We've got some decks and egress. And then if you flip, basically this is what we're talking about in terms of afterwards. We have a 3-foot plus or minus. It goes to 7 foot in this location back here. You go from a 16-foot high wall to an 11-foot high wall. This was a change that we made. This previously was a 15-foot high wall. We brought it down because we could. Basically, we're just slotting cars under there, so we could bring that roof height down a little bit and improve that height. Next slide. Condition at 20 Green Street, 22-foot plus or minus at the top of the ridge, 16-foot back from their property line. You'll see our 3 feet. You'll see our 15 feet here. Slide. Current condition, there's an existing shed in the foreground here, current 16-foot wall. If you click to the next slide, you'll see the proposed condition. Again, we've talked many times about sort of the planted buffer that's up here. You know, these plantings are just, could be something different than what's shown. But plantings, we would be happy to plant something if our neighbors preferred to plant something or didn't prefer to plant something, we'd be happy to work with them to figure out how to use that 3 feet or 7 feet in some cases. Again, it's our intention. We would sign an agreement with our neighbors basically to use that land. We want to formalize that agreement. Obviously, we want to be able to get there, back there and fix the wall or do anything like that, but in terms of our neighbors' use of that property, we're happy to have them use it and care for it. Next slide. So again, 28 Green Street, about 10 foot off the property line. Here it's 7 feet back. Again, that's where it goes from 3 feet to 7 feet, and then you see 15 feet being maintained throughout. Next slide, perspectives. You see that change from 3 feet to 7 feet here. You see, I'm sorry, this is where, this is the existing building, and where the building does sort of jut in and then go off. And it is about 16 feet. Now if you go to the next slide, there you go. You see that hitch from 3 feet to 7 feet. You see the 11 foot height of the wall back here. And then you see about a 17 foot setback once you add in on both sides of the property line. So next slide. So again, if you're looking just from Green Street in an imaginary view, talked about fenestration elevations of the Green Street side. This is what basically you've seen in perspectives. You see the courtyard here. You see the building that fronts along Gould Street in the distance. You'd see the two wings that cut towards Green Street coming out. The other thing that we did was we reduced, and you'll see it in the next one, we reduced the number of windows along the Green Street facade. Just responding to some of the questions about privacy and light and that kind of stuff. And you'll see just in, again sort of the buffer plantings that we have in schematic form. So if you go to the next slide, just this was a comparison of the window type that we had along the Green Street facade and what it is now. If you just go back, Julie, sorry, thank you. You'll see those changes and some of that more, some more of that detailing. So the next page, just real quickly, a summary of the changes, and then I'm going to hand it over to Tom to talk about traffic. We have further gross square foot reduction. We have the unit reduction. And again, from 58 to 55, we have an increase in the parking of the garage and increase in the setback on the ground floor. Again, we talked about 3 foot to 7 foot, and then the 15-foot setback on floors 2 through 4. And that reduced height along the parking deck along the Green Street facade. So that's just some of the things that we did from the last meeting to this meeting to respond to the feedback that we've gotten. And I know another thing we wanted to talk about was the traffic study, so I'm going to jump right into that. We can cover all the questions at the end if that works for everyone. So Tom, you take it away.
Greetings, everybody. I've given a lot of presentations in Eastern Mass, but I've never given a presentation in Reading, so it's the first time, so it's nice to see new faces. It's a lot of fun. So, traffic study, Gold Street project. So, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on existing conditions. I'm guessing that most of you are very interested in delay and capacity concerns. That's what most communities are most concerned with. But as you sort of got a background on what's going to happen with mixed-use commercial and retail, commercial and residential, and the new development of 55 dwelling units and 3,700 square feet of commercial. So you kind of have a background on what's going on. So we'll just continue on to the traffic portion. Give you an idea, I'm sorry.
Is this what you wanted?
Yep. Okay. So, you guys can rest assured that we followed the MassDOT guidelines for traffic impact studies. That included getting peak hour counts to our AM to our PM counts at these seven intersections, and also getting 48-hour counts along Main Street. So, next slide. This is where we got the 48-hour counts from. And the red circles are where we got the peak hour counts from in order to build the traffic model. Next slide. So very quickly, these are the signalized intersections. I'm sure you guys recognize these intersections along Main Street. Next slide. The unsignalized intersections include these, Ash at Gould, Haven at Gould. Next slide. Also Washington Street at Ash, Haven at High, also existing unsignalized. Safety analysis, relatively safe intersections. There weren't any fatals. There were five of the seven that were below state averages. The two that were above state averages didn't have fatals or very few injuries. And they were due, as you can see here, due to bigger issues, geometric issues. Why the crashes occurred. So we'll go on to the next slide. All right, so trip generation. This is the start of the capacity analysis. There's multi-steps. Step one is trip generation, then distribution, then mode split, and then route assignment. That's how you do a traffic study. You'll notice here that we decided to be conservative. Actually, Julie, we called up Julie and said, Julie, can we assume that there's a lot of bus trips? Because if you see here, 12% of people use the bus, and there's some people walking and biking, and Julie said, let's be conservative, let's just assume 100% driving. We did assume, we did use the 4.4% the carpool, but other than that, we went with zero biking, zero walking, zero busing. Let's just assume that people are driving. So that's what we did here to come up with the trips. This is a trip generation. So here you can see here when we came up with the trips, 59 a.m. trips and 71 p.m. trips. These are unadjusted trips. We We also took into account the existing commercial property there. We actually did empirical counts, meaning we went out there and counted the 21 a.m., also 21 p.m. existing trips out there. So when we did the study, we assumed the net impact on the development. So our net vehicle trips of 38 a.m. and 50 p.m., I did want to point out that's per hour. I've done these studies in the past and people say, well, really during rush hour? You know, rush hour can be from 6 a.m. to 10 a.m., but this is per hour, so you can actually have that many trips every hour. Now, to get an idea, 50 trips per hour on average, 60 minutes in an hour, so maybe roughly one trip a minute. Minute goes by, another trip. Minute goes by, another trip. And we're talking intersections that have roughly 1,000 trips per hour, okay? So this is just sort of like, I always like to get my hands dirty and kind of like feel the numbers. You go out to a street, all right, so this street has about 1,000 trips per hour, and this development is gonna add about a trip per minute. So you have 1,000 trips, boom, a minute goes by, another trip. So the reason why you'll see when we get to later slides that there's no change in level of service. And this is the salient slide to explain that. Because when you have 1,000 trips per hour and roughly a trip per minute, it's difficult to get the delay, increase the delay so much that you have a big impact. Like you have to wait. Who likes waiting at intersections? Nobody, right? So this is what it basically measures, is the delay. If you wait more than 80 seconds at a signalized intersection or more than 50 seconds at a non-signalized intersection, then you have level service F, right? You fail. But none of these intersections go to a fail or even change. In fact, none of the movements actually change in level of service. So these are the numbers to kind of keep in mind. One trip per minute. So we'll go to the next slide. This is what we, the census tract that we used. Next slide. We assumed that we went through the trip distribution. The trip distribution was, I apologize for the poor quality. I'm just noticing that right now. So there's poor quality, it's really hard to read. But these are the intersections we chose, and we can assure you that we use the MassDOT guidelines. This is all to standard. We couldn't look at every intersection in Reading. So we did have to pick and choose, and we did get this approved by the town. You'll notice that Green Street's not on here, so we consolidated to bring the trips to here. Some of them go down Ash or down Green Street, but nonetheless, we did use the official guidelines in case anyone's looking at this and saying, well, why do you leave out my intersection or my neighborhood? So we'll go on to the next slide. And then, so you guys saw that the site generated trips from the earlier slide of 50 trips. We basically took those trips and distributed them using the traffic model onto the network. So this is the number of trips onto the network. The slide before this was the percentage at every intersection. Next slide. These are the volumes. The build volumes just means, so build versus no build. No build is if the project doesn't get built. How many trips are there in the build are the trips generated plus the no build volumes 7 years into the future are the build volumes. So this is the volumes that you're going to see at every intersection 7 years into the future. So we'll skip to the fun slide. So next slide. Here is a fun slide. This is debatably the most important slide in the whole presentation. So if you guys were asleep up until now, you can wake up and look at this slide. This is the one that says, who has kids here who bring home report cards, right? Some of you? The A through F is similar to a report card. It's a way of measuring qualitatively each intersection and quantitatively because, like I said before, if you get to 80 seconds, you become an F. You can see there are, so there's an F here, for example, at Washington and Main in one of the movements. And the traffic model basically compares the no build versus the build, which I mentioned before. So if the project didn't get built, what would happen 7 years into the future? And we did take into account other developments. Reading Woods, a couple other ones. The Postmark Square, by the way, the new Postmark Square, the trip generator is going to be less than the current trips. So we didn't include it in here because the net trips is zero. But we did include all other developments in the area, and we included the background growth. We went to the Metropolitan Planning Organization, and we said, what's the growth? And then we made a conservative adjustment, and then we assumed the background growth to get to the 2024 no build. And you can see here the level of service degrades in all these places where it's highlighted in orange, right? So you can see here it goes from E to F here, and from C to D here. So there's a few places where it gets worse. However, in the build condition, there are no movements that degrade in level of service. And it kind of goes back to, well, a trip a minute on average onto a street with 1,000 trips per hour. It's just not enough to put it over the edge. And you can see here, none of the movements degrade, none of the intersections degrade. There are increases, but they're small. The average 0.7 seconds, so if you're in a car, it's barely enough time to change the station on the radio. So you won't see large increases in delay. Next slide. So, last slide. Conclusion. 55 residential dwelling units, 3,700 square feet of retail space. There's no fatals. There's no significant safety issues to be addressed. Trip generation, 100% vehicle usage was assumed for the project, meaning no bus, bike, walk was assumed. Expected to generate 38 a.m. trips net, of course, 50 p.m. peak hour trips, once again, net, less than one trip per minute on average. And zero movements degrade in level of service in the network. I don't know if we're going to do a Q&A now or later.
In just a
okay.
minute.
All right. Well, I'll be.
I'm just going to really quickly hit on, thank you, Tom, and really quickly hit on just perspectives on parking ratios. Just to give some examples of both Reading projects and projects that we own and manage, what we experience in terms of parking. So this just basically shows, you know, 24 Gould, the market to affordable in terms of units, just because that actually does dictate, surprisingly, how much car usage there is, or maybe not surprisingly. What we've put in here is 69 spaces, gets us to 1.25, which we now have in the garage. At 30 Haven, we talked to the property manager just the other day. They have 53 units. They're full. They have 20% affordability. And the residential parking built was 63 residential units. They're actually using 61. So they have an actual parking count ratio of 1.15. The Box District in Chelsea was another smart growth project, actually not as good a transit location as this location. We have 49 units built across three different buildings, and 21% of those are affordable. We built out 173 parking spaces. We currently use only 153 for those 149 spaces. We just put out a special for parking, and we, you know, got one or two takers, and so we're at 1.03 in the Box District. Coolidge School Apartments is a 55 plus age restricted in Watertown, 38 units, 40% affordable. We had 75 parking spaces there. We only use 41, and we're at 1.07. And I think we've consistently seen these numbers, you know, sort of stay flat or even sort of trail down as we have owned them. You know, these are two projects. This is probably about 8 years old, 5 years old, and 30 Haven is a couple years old as well. 7 years old. So just to give you some perspective on where sort of parking ratios are, in our experience, obviously we don't. There are others who have experience out there. I just wanted to make that known. So if you can click to the next slide. We'd be happy to take your questions appreciate the time.
Thanks. We're going to do board questions first and then we'll take public comments.
me the breakdown of one bedroom, two bedroom, and three bedroom units?
Yes. Excuse me while I pull it up. So we have 29 one bedrooms, 21 two bedrooms, and 6 3 bedrooms.
That's 56 units.
Did I write it down wrong?
Five. We have 5 3 beds.
5 3 beds, I apologize.
Okay. And the, so which floor is the only, which floor only has one 3 bedroom?
If you look at floor 2, right here, hard to see on here, but it's this one.
Okay.
I'm sorry, this is the first one.
Apologize about that.
Second floor.
Level 2.
Yeah, level 2.
Can you walk me through how the trash is going to get in and out of the building again and how you're going to deal with loading with the 11-foot opening on that?
Mm-hmm. So we go back. So again, sort of, so there's trash chutes on every level. There's two doors on every level, recycling and trash. So residents will just go on their floor, drop it down the chute. It'll end up in a compactor here. And basically these carts can be rolled out. So the trash can come in here, carts can be rolled out and loaded in. And you know, again, because we have this space open now, we just have a lot more room to maneuver with the trash trucks. So this happens on any number of our sort of projects where, you know, we've got trash chutes, trash compactors, and maintenance works with the trash company basically to get them out the double doors and get them towards the street. And it happens, there's nothing that's left on the sidewalk ever.
But the trash truck won't be able to pull in, it'll be on the street.
It'll be on the street basically,
okay.
And you know, pull in here. And basically the whole operation is probably about 20 minutes. You know, it's very quick. At properties of this size, it's about 2 times a week.
How about like resident load in and load out being residential, you know, the 30th of the month?
Mm-hmm. So we now have the 5 spaces here, which are, you know, standard size spaces angled in, which are short term, intended to be short term. So for short term delivery, short term loading, the UPS truck, the postal service truck. We anticipate this. For in terms of move-ins, we have a lot more space back here. We will actively use this space and this drive aisle here and along here. And basically, this is, you know, this is a building that's going to have a manager here on site. So they're going to be, and a maintenance person as well, they're going to be actively, you know, managing this area. In the day, I expect this, you know, based on our other developments, I expect that this will be 50% full. And generally, we will ask residents to move in during weekdays and times when we have more time and more space and when the elevator is not in use as much, because that's another thing. We actually have to lock down the elevator, have people move in and out. So we give them very specific windows when we know that they can fit in the garage and load and unload into the elevator.
One elevator for this entire property?
Yes, one elevator.
How about, if let's say you mentioned a potential grocery store going in the front.
Mm-hmm.
18 wheels pulling up to do their deliveries.
So, well, any retailer that requires 18 wheelers for deliveries will not be a retailer here. I can just tell you that. Basically, what we get is you know, box trucks, vans, that kind of sort of level of delivery for retailers of this size. Again, this is up to 3,700 square feet. It could possibly be subdivided. They can use these short-term parking spots we can also accommodate them in here as well. But an 18-wheeler moving up Gould Street, you know, it's...
It doesn't work.
It doesn't work, and it's not, and a retailer who requires that is not going to locate here.
It's a great idea, but you often can't control what your supplier sent.
Well, we could certainly prohibit it in our lease that what drop-ins and times are, and we do at all of our... I mean, so 225 Center in Jamaica Plain, we have a burger and fry kind of joint. You know, we tell them when they can have deliveries and when they can't, because we have 103 residential units above, and we don't want our, not to mention the whole rest of the neighborhood, but just selfishly, we don't want our residents, you know, conflicting with deliveries and, you know, getting woken up by a delivery at 5 o'clock in the morning or anything like that. We don't want them, you know, competing with an 18-wheeler on Gould Street.
I have no new questions at this point.
I guess this is not the latest parking. So how many compact parking spaces do we have there?
The latest plan, I think it's about...
It's about 33. Depending upon which scheme it is. If it's, it should be 33.
Is that the scheme?
Yes.
Is that
right
it?
Here.
Yeah. Well, we'll just count them.
So we have... spaces out of 69.
37
out of 69.
53%. 54%. I'll give you the one. I'm going to say 53%. This is kind of something I've been thinking about since John mentioned last time about this 1.25 being some number you stick to. And when we wrote the zoning, and this came up because John mentioned that and kind of reviewed the whole PowerPoint presentation that we did. One of the questions that came up was why no setbacks and why this parking number? Because those are what limit the size of the project. Because you have to fit the parking in. You have to do something with the building to step back, you know, to make it look nice, but also to get it to fit and work for you. And then that eventually determines how many units can fit. We didn't write into this design standard the limit on the compact parking, but we did do it on Gateway. And the Mass Smart Growth Guidelines limit it as well, or at least recommend 30%. So this is 53%. And not only that, but they're smaller than the recommended size, 7.5 feet.
They're the Cambridge standard.
Versus the Smart Growth Guide, which is saying 8 by 17, either is like 7.5 by 16.
For what it's worth,
yeah.
So that probably, I mean, I was just counting before I saw this change here, but you're probably losing three spots if you have to reduce it down to some reasonable number, let's say 40%. So then you're lower than the 125. Does that reduce your unit count? You know, that's what, but before I saw this parking lot, that's what I was thinking was, that you really only, if you brought the compact parking numbers down to the 30% or 35%, you're going to lose three or four spaces. That's going to require you to get rid of a unit or two to get into that. Well, this is when you also had the outdoor parking, so you're going to be well below the 125. It's a concern to me that there are this many compact parking spaces that are also smaller than they need to be.
And in relation, and as a guide to density, or
yeah,
as a guide to usability?
As a controlling guide to the density.
Just the number of households.
Yeah.
Because from a density of built envelope, we're well below the standard of FAR, right?
Yeah, no, I
so
think you've done an admirable job on the back side of this property to start scaling it back. That's fine. But FAR has never been one of those things I've thought of as...
Yeah.
as something that, that says anything really in this, this level of development.
So it's just less doors in the building, less number of, you know, people that are living there. That's what you're trying to control. The building size is the building size, but in terms of the number of people walking through the front door that say I live there,
yeah,
that's what you're trying to pinpoint.
And that, that would reduce the building size to some extent. Let's say you lost two units. The Green Street side of the top floor could step back again. You know, because you, you'd get rid of the, you'd change the count a little bit up there. You get four units on the wings, right?
It, that could be one response that we would make to reducing the number of units. The other response is that we could, it might, I mean, we would look at the number, we would look at the economics of it, but the other response would be just to make a larger unit, potentially. So there's, you know, there's two ways to potentially solve the problem. And that's why I'm trying to get at, is it building envelope, or is it the number of doors down the corridor?
Yeah, it's density unit count. Density unit count, that's how I think about it. Less people, less cars, less units. So that's my concern with the compact spaces, because it's two things. It's, there's well over the 30% guide, and they're smaller. So, you know, you can make them all compact, let's say, right? Make them 100% compact and say you're allowed 65 units. But that's sort of not really in the spirit of the thing was written.
I mean, I, a couple of things that I would just urge further thought about, and that's number one is the whether the Gould Street spaces, the five spaces, while they're not targeted towards residential overnight parking, and I get that, they are serving residential purposes to a degree. And those are not in any of the, you know, when we say 69 units in the garage, that's not including the Gould Street five spaces. And, you know, that's, any one of you can take it any way, any way you want, whether it's, in the, whether it's in the ratio or not. They're there, we're happy to have them, we think it's a great idea, we want to give the town an easement to do it. The other thing is just, you know, I think going back to the parking ratios that we see at our other properties, you know, it's, some people like to say if you build it, they will come. And what we found is if you build it, they're going to have as many cars as they're going to have. You know, and building out additional parking, you know, has a cost and to the project, and so, you know, we think very, we think really hard about it, and we track it continually. So.
Yeah, I'm not suggesting to build more parking. I'm saying you have less spaces.
I understand. I'm just saying, in terms of the ratios that we actually see. But I understand you're using it as a limit on density.
I would urge you, when you do your parking calculations, to include those so that you're not constantly going, well, that includes it and it doesn't include those. The, I'm sorry, the five spaces
yeah,
in front.
I understand.
I know when we originally, years ago, talked about the 1.25, one of the things that was part of that discussion was, you know, understanding that everyone wasn't going to need two spaces, or you know, that, that the likely space requirement's going to be lower just from residential for 1.25, but there is some need for visitor spaces, and that's part of what that 1.25 was supposed to encompass. So, you know, just for clarity, and that's really what those five spaces out front is, that sort of rotating that temporary use. So I would encourage, just so that we're all have the same,
yeah,
using
so
the same set of calculations, you know, I would encourage you to keep referring to those as being part of your.
So you think the 125 included the
for
space?
Yeah, well, for if they're in control of it, yeah.
Well, but they're not going to be. it's they're going to give an easement to the town and it's going to be public.
Yeah, it's on the town property.
The five spaces out front are great for all the incidental stuff.
And it's
going to
be like 30-minute parking.
Is that the
or,
plan?
Or, you know, something like that.
Recommendation of the PT.
TT,
yeah. is that they be like 30-minute or less parking, I think, you know.
30-minute,
and deeded to the town?
Well, yeah, because they're not entirely on private property. They're only partially on private property. So they're partly in Gold Street.
That's correct.
Yeah.
Yep.
Because that then becomes a whole problem because the building manager will actually have to manage those five parking spaces because it's in essence going to be your loading zone. So we need to think about how that is going to work.
I mean, generally how it works in our experience is just that you have a sign there that looks like every other sign in Reading. It says 30-minute parking only. And it's, you know, policed and managed just like any other parking spot in the town of Reading. And so, and certainly if our manager sees, you know, somebody parking there overnight, we're going to be calling, you know, the folks and alerting them to that.
I guess, you know, going back to the whole loading thing is that, you know, when someone comes in with their U-Haul that's over 11 feet, because they, most of them are, I guess when you were talking through that, I was thinking that you were going to have the ability to manage those five spots in front so that, you know, you could, you know, block those off for that period because those trucks are not going to be able to get into that parking garage. It's 11 feet. You're only going to be able to get a van. So you're really going to have to be able to manage some space in front, whether it's those or somewhere else, so that it's whether it's loading for the residential or loading for the service for the retail use. There's
Julie, can
I'm
you drop
sure
back to the
there's still street parking along the west edge, right?
Yep. So I was just going to go back. There's still four spaces along this edge here. Mm-hmm. You know, when we talk about visitors and people coming and going from the building, you know, And what's the relevance potentially of, you know, on-street parking availability or not? You know, it's very relevant to visitors. It's very relevant to quick trips into the retail, that kind of thing. So that's one thing. The second is we do have this space with, you know, in front of this opening. You know, is it, you know, again, we're going to be managing our move-ins so that they're in non-peak times. We don't want to have somebody moving into the building at 7:30 on a Monday morning. And so in terms of usage of this space that's out front here, this space that's out front here where people can still get by, yeah, it creates a little bit of a bottleneck. But again, that's why we have a manager or maintenance person to do that kind of thing. But you're right. This is not going to be, you know, in our complete control.
Then I take back what I said before.
I wish it didn't say it. I wish it was, but it's not.
So then the other thing I have is with the traffic study. I'm really confused why Green Street's not on that. I don't understand this. Yeah, but there's no way, given what happens on Washington Street, at the intersection of Washington Street, somebody who has to get to High Street or, you know, is going to go down to Washington Street. They're gonna go down Green Street. So what is the count?
So
what are the peak counts for people that would make
it? What I can tell you, and I've been doing this for 18 years, right? So I've done a lot of these, is that we pick and choose how many intersections we study. And for this project, it's actually more than most intersections. I just did 100-unit development in Boston. They had two intersections. So we could have just done two intersections and done this. However, I think we went above and beyond 6-7. We opted not to do Green Street. We consolidated trips. We have 8 trips in the AM and 2 trips in the PM, right? And some fraction of those 8 trips in the AM will go along, right? So some fraction of those 8 will go here and some will do this. And the PM, some fraction of the 2, you might have 1 do this and 1 do that. It's just not big enough of a number to actually need it. You know, so we went by the guideline.
I understand, but I think everybody understood that the additional traffic would not be a significant impact on the total car trips. Like you said, 50 out of 1,000.
Yeah.
We knew that.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean anything, really, because
yeah.
you're not going to impact the level of service. What I want to know is what the peak numbers are. Let's say everybody leaving Gould Street is going to turn right onto Green Street. What's that number at both peaks?
So it's, if it's 100%, then it's 8 in the a.m. and 2 in the p.m. It's a very small number. That's if it's 100%. That's if nobody does this.
It just seems really low. You said that there were peak numbers of, you said there were peak numbers of 50 and 79.
Yeah, so if you start 50.
38 and.
Right. But 50 is in the PM, and that's entering and exiting, right? So 50 includes entering and exiting. That's total trips. So even if it's half and half, I don't have it memorized, but let's say it's 25. Then a fraction go this way and a fraction go this
one
way.
No, it's one way.
Oh, yeah, that's right. I apologize. It's one way.
Yeah.
So then you have trips going this way.
No, other way.
So if it's... If it's 12, or if this is 8, okay, so I have it right here. That's very helpful. So we'll go ahead and start, let's see, site area trips while we go. All right, we'll start with AM. So we have 26 going right, 9 going this way, 17 going this way, right? So we have 17 coming down here. Of those, 8 go in this direction. So even if they didn't do this, even if all 8 did this, the rest of those 9 trips go this way. You just have a distribution of trips where you only have 8 going that way. Is that making
sense? That's based on what you've observed that they're doing now? Which way
exactly. It's based on existing trip distribution, which is how all the traffic studies are done.
So 17, if we assumed all of them went down Green Street, it'd be 17.
No, because the other ones go.
I know.
I'm sorry?
So here's how I think about traffic.
Yeah.
Traffic study is this black box that you throw some numbers in and try to get something quantitative out of.
Mm-hmm.
Because we're trying to figure out what people do. But people do stupid things. Seeing somebody bang a U-turn on South Street in the middle of the intersection because they realize they're going the wrong way. So let's just assume, just tell me the maximum number getting to intersection number 2.
Yeah.
And then for some unknown reason, there's free donuts.
Yeah.
Provided by Gene.
Mm-hmm.
On High Street. So they're all going to turn right onto Green. What's that number?
That's Ash.
I'm sorry. But you're
Ash
on Ash Street, but
yes.
Now you're going to turn onto Green Street.
Mm-hmm. 17 was not.
Like, so you're turning,
yeah.
like,
you're
going
so,
down here and turning
yeah,
down here
there you
to
go.
High Street.
If
everybody's going to do that, there's a party, there's free
if
donuts.
It's, if it's Dunkin' Donuts, then all 26 are doing this.
No, they're not.
But according to the existing trip distribution, 17 are coming down here, 9 are doing this.
Mm-hmm.
But there's generators over here. So not all 17 want to come here.
But it would only be 17 is what I'm trying to get at.
Yes.
I mean, it's not a significant number.
Yeah.
If
yeah.
you were telling me that it was 50, I would be very concerned.
Sure.
But you're saying it's 7. It's
17 are
17.
Turning right on Ash. Some of them are coming here. Only 8 of them want to get here. So the most that you'd really see is 8 if 100% don't do this movement and do this movement.
Yeah, I don't think I don't think it's all of the trips, but I certainly don't think anyone's going to go down to Washington to then go back up to High Street.
Well, if there's cars parked on both sides of the street, as there, every time I've driven down there, there are, and you drive slow, which everyone should be down that street, there are plenty of people that will go down to go all the way down and turn right because it's a more free flowing street. It's you have to. Where I pay attention a little bit less behind the parked cars. So I don't think it's all that crazy that people would go all the way down instead of coming through Green Street. Just because of the resistance of Green Street, parked cars and narrow.
And the fact that it's a four-way stop and you're turning right up a hill. I mean, it's...
Yeah.
I've been in the town for 30 years. I don't think I've ever taken that turn.
So, but I think, so if I can bust in here a little bit. So what I took out of this is, because I think the two intersections that we've heard the most discussion about and have the most comment about are the trips being generated out of the development and coming up Gold Street to Ash Street, and then I'm going to say coming down Ash, whether they take the right on Green or keep going. So I guess I just want to put this all in perspective, and to me, these numbers, in terms of the, even though they're small, they make sense to me, in that you're saying that there's going to be 26 trips during the peak hour generated. That's the AM peak. So that makes sense, right? If you have 60, if you have, 60 cars in there, let's say, you spread those 60 cars, everyone's not going to leave during the same hour. It's spread. Some people are early risers, some people are late, all of those. So during that hour, it seems reasonable to me that during the peak hour, probably 7:30 to 8:30, let's call it, you're going to have close to half of those cars leaving. To me, that seems reasonable. The thing, and then we talked about how those all disperse. That all makes sense. The thing that jumps out to me is that, so at that Gold Street, Ash Street intersection, right now you are saying that there are, we're looking at the AM, there's about 55 cars during the AM peak that come up and dip to that intersection. You'll add on your 20, 25, 26 cars. That's all well and fine. Not that, it will be a change, but not that much of a change. What jumps out at me is that what you're having here is, showing here is that there will be, when you add everything else in, that there will be 160 cars during the peak hour using that intersection.
Including existing trips,
your trips, and I'm going to say everyone else's trips.
Sure.
So I just wanted to put that out there, that it's, that you're projecting that there is going to be a change. I think that's what I took out of this whole 100 or 300 pages, that there is going to be a change. A small part of it's generated by your development. There's going to be other, the other developments in town and just general growth that, there is going to be some traffic changes in downtown.
That's a 2024 number.
That's
correct?
A 2024 number.
Correct.
So,
that is not tomorrow.
So even, and as we've seen, that's a good point. So as we've seen, that oftentimes what happens when traffic gets too bad, people figure other stuff out, like taking commuter rail, going different routes.
Different route, different mode, different time of day when the trip isn't made.
Yes.
It's forced.
Yeah.
Generally,
yeah.
What happens? Yeah.
Because really, if you take that little, take all those numbers that we just talked about, that, and then multiply that same kind of growth at Main and Washington, that's which we all know is the problem child here in terms of traffic in downtown Reading. That then becomes a problem. So I think, I guess where I'm going to is, I'm not all that concerned about the 25 trips that your site generates in. That even gets to be a smaller issue when you see all the rest of the growth, all the rest of the changes that are happening, not only in Reading, but sort of in the whole network.
Good point about the commuter rail, too, since we assume zero commuter rail here, and ideally something close to the commuter rail, they'll use the commuter rail more.
Yeah, and that 12% is a is a reasonable number, and I wouldn't, I would think that something is that this would probably do that or higher. Not really a question, just more of a making sure that I was interpreting this information this way.
And the only other thing I had was the proposed setbacks. Have you already met with the neighbors about that one? Or is this the first time they're seeing it?
Have we talked to the neighbors about it?
No.
And I mean, the 3 foot has been around for a couple weeks, but in terms of the 7 foot, no. This is, I think,
and also the 15, no.
And the 15, no.
Okay.
So.
John, do you have another
one for now? Yeah.
Rachel? Good. All right, public comments. So if you haven't already signed in, make sure you do before you leave. State your name and address so we can get into the record and be polite.
The parking study.
Name?
Oh, Lorraine Wilmore. Did you include the people that belong to the restaurant or the shops that live in the building? Is there any way to understand how many people would be coming in and out all day long to a restaurant? Or?
I mean, we didn't specify exactly where they went. It was basically, you know, we had a number of spots and we were utilization rate for a 15-minute period.
So a lot of people that would go in and out of the shop? Like if there's a, you know, a couple retailers and a coffee shop, or hopefully not a burger shop.
With mobility studies, what we've noticed is that because retail is very parking intensive during the day and residential is very parking intensive during the night, they're actually complementary uses. And the most intensive is definitely in the night. So the peak is when people come home from work. And then during the day, they just can't match that peak. There's so many people that come home from work and use those spots. So when we looked at the max were just, you know, the middle of the night rates were just the highest usage.
So the 26 extra people going up and down the street was only during the rush hour, 1 hour in the morning, 1 hour in the afternoon, not all day long.
Exactly.
Live on that street.
Exactly.
Another thing is there any way you can add in the Green Street coupon? Because that is a cut through. Everybody cuts down from Green Street. We just still need to go out to Washington. It's silly. It's gridlock right there. So
could
you add that in?
In theory, we could build another model on it. I have to ask Dave if it wouldn't affect anything. So it would be like a hamster wheel spinning.
I think what you could assume is if you took
the entire number
and sent it down Green Street, and that's what I was trying to get to was if you assume there's a roadblock at Ash and Washington.
Uh-huh.
Just assume all the cars go down Green Street, and that was the total number you told me, and that was 26.
Mm-hmm. But that's just during those 2 hours.
That's
I just want to know, you know, all day long, it's going to happen all day long. So I guess I thought the parking study was going to show me how many more cars per day are going to go down our street. I don't know, because that can vary. It just depends. I just wanted to ask if we included
it. Is that a number that can be rounded up?
So again, just in terms of the number, again, to Nick's exact point, and it's somewhere up here, but if Ash and Washington is blocked off at peak times, there's 8 people that take a right from Ash onto Washington. If they're not able to do that, yes, they might do that on Green Street. So those 8 people might go right onto Green Street at the peak time in the AM. It's 2 people in the peak time in the PM. In terms of just adding that up over the day, I imagine we can do that. Because you know there's going to be peak and there's going to be non-peak, right? And so it's going to be less than 8 and less than 2 that would ever go down this. And
yeah, it's a pretty busy street.
There are situations when I think you are.
Could
not
you state
really
your name first?
I'm sorry. Lenka Nichols.
Nice.
I live on corner of Ash and Green. So it doesn't matter if the car is going straight or is turning or whatever they do, they will go by my house. And I'm very scared about this whole situation. Again, you know, You know, there has been some changes in town in the past that, you know, just, you know, keep affecting me and will continue to affect me. And this add more 25 more cars, or, well, okay, 17, and so that's an hour. You know, I can just see another future decrease of the quality of my life here, you know. My family, you know, and the neighbors. So if I'm parking, I'm doing like this kind of, you know, I kind of block the air street and I'm backing into my parking spot. I can see how people are, they don't want to wait. They don't wait for me to actually park. That's what they do. They turn and go down Green Street. If there is a truck in front, a bit at the back of the Dunkin' Donuts or the other Jumbo store, there is a truck, people are, they don't want to wait, they are turning on Green Street.
Right.
You know. Then you telling me, so you will do two trash pickups, you know, a week. So that's another, so it's regular trash, recycling trash, so that's another four more dumpster trucks going by my house.
Yeah.
They are not going to go up. They are going, they will be turning right because, you know, it doesn't make sense for them to go left.
They're likely to go right and go right down to Washington, though. They're not likely to
come
down.
Then you have the so if there's more cars going towards, kind of, if they turn left, they go to Main Street, they stop at the light, you know. So now the Main Street is almost, you know, there's more, so the light turns red for the cars on Main Street, and people using Ash Street as the cut through to avoid these three lights, right? At Haven Street, the little one, Ash and Main and Washington Main. So they cut through that little parking lot and head down Ash. And they use it as another kind of lane, extra lane to Main Street, and I see it happening.
Okay.
It's happening every single
study,
day.
I think that the study
and
has
they,
taken account, this level of study, the study has shown that the level of service takes into account the movements that are happening on those areas now.
Well, I just see that, you know, as you said, you know, if there is more cars, more traffic, people find other ways. And that's what already is happening. That's already happened to Ash Street because we didn't have, 5 years ago, we didn't have that amount of traffic we had. There was like tremendous increase of traffic. I know because I lived there. You know, there was like, it was multiple times more traffic we got than we used to.
Okay.
And no sidewalk for me in front of my house because it wasn't convenient for the town. Somehow, you know, the town was thinking about traffic, not about the residents.
I can't speak to that.
My house has no setback from Ash Street at all, and I have no sidewalk.
Okay.
Just throwing it in, just my little complaint.
I just wanted to know.
Have your name, please.
Oh, sorry.
Sorry, it's just about to enter into the record. So.
Carrie Grant, I live at 32 Green. I just wanted to know why Green Street was excluded from the study.
So we touched on that, but I'm happy to elucidate it as well. When we do a study, we have to pick and choose. We obviously can't do everything already. Usually studies of this size in terms of number of dwelling units, we'd only pick two or three intersections.
Mm-hmm.
In this case, you can see here, we actually picked seven, which is more than is typical for a project of this size. We opted not to pick Queen Street, it's a very small street, by consolidating the two. So the trips at the beginning and the end, those eight trips, even if we assume all eight trips go on Green Street instead of going down Ash and Washington, the delay and the level of service would be the same. The delay meaning how much you're waiting when you get to
Haven. It wouldn't be though, because people come onto Green off of Main Street as well. So there's a big difference in the amount of cars that go down Green versus down Ash Street.
So if you imagine all eight of those trips over the course of an hour, so one car every 6 minutes, 6 minutes goes by another car, 6 minutes, and it's a stop control intersection at the end of Green Street. 6 minutes go by another car.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so you wait behind one car for every 6 minutes. You're not going to have an increasing delay. I mean, it might be 0.0001 seconds.
No, what I'm saying is the traffic down in that area, because I have a child, so we go play in the neighbor's driveway all the time. We see the amount of cars that come down that street, and
mm-hmm.
they fly down that street.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, we always put something on the end of the driveway so we make sure people slow down, but they don't. There is a high volume of cars that go down that street.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I think what we're trying to study, though, is our contribution to the overall. So it's a good point, and it's a good concern if people use that as a cut through. And it's, but what we're trying to show is what is our contribution to that problem.
Yeah.
And what we're saying is that our contribution to that in terms of is at the peak, 8 cars down Green Street. If everybody decides to go down Green Street as opposed to take a right on Washington from Ash. And so we can't necessarily solve the Green Street.
I totally understand that.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's,
no, it's just the traffic issue, and then on top your whatever how many people coming down Green Street.
Yes.
Well, that's what they're telling you. They're telling you that it's a peak.
Right.
So
on top of what's already coming down.
So we do want to, right, we want to be aware of what we're talking about, the difference between, what a traffic study does is look at whether they're going to add up so much traffic that one of the intersection fails. That's not going to happen. What you're talking about is increase of traffic, and you will notice a change,
mm-hmm.
not necessarily all from them and probably not very much from them, but you will notice a change between now and 2024 in the number of cars that go down Green Street.
Mm-hmm.
And so, but it's not sort of all that we can, we can't keep the street, we can't fix the existing problem,
totally.
And we can't keep the street so that there is
no more traffic,
right? And so we sort of need to realize that, you know, what we can do, what we're looking at is it to a point where it's broken, and not whether it will change at all, and it will change, but not to a point where it's going to be considered broken. Does that make sense?
I had a concern relative to waste management and disposal. I think David mentioned that it would take 20 minutes to take out the trash into a vehicle that's blocking Gould Street. That's
I don't think he never said it was going to block Gould Street.
It's not good.
Okay,
that was it.
But the vehicle is going to be parked on Gould Street while it gets loaded. It's going to come into your parking garage because that was.
Again, Julie, you mind jumping back to that parking deck?
Because I've listened to this 3 times now, and each time you said to the street, and that's why my concern, if it's going to take some time to load up and block the road, that's a major safety concern.
So it's not going to block the road.
Okay.
We don't want it to block the road,
okay.
because our people also need to get in and out,
mm-hmm.
go about their day. But essentially, there is an opening right here. First of all, there's a wide swath here where, let's just imagine for a second, and to John's point, it won't happen very often. There's an indentation here where, you know, in theory, somebody could come in, if nobody was parked here, and pull off of Gould Street and jump out of their car and do something in here. That's not likely to happen because, you know, somebody will be parked there for 30 minutes and doing something or whatever. But there's also a section here that has the same sort of ability for a truck to pull off and get out of the way of Gould Street traffic that's going by. Okay? And essentially what happens again is these get rolled out, these get pushed out, that happens, nothing is sitting on the sidewalk. We don't want to be blocking Gould Street either.
In the back?
My name is Wayne Fire, 61 Ash. I live on the corner of Ash and Pool. One point is, I think when the Atlantic was open, trucks would come up to the end of Gould, turn right on Ash, they'd knock out the stop sign.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that it's a safety hazard if there's no stop, if that happened, that cars come in, they don't see a stop sign. So I think that it would be good to put that in the lease about the size of the trucks coming. It hasn't happened in a long time, but it did happen before. I've lived there like over 20 years.
Do you understand that?
And my other question is, there is a sidewalk where those angled spaces are in front of the building. Is there a sidewalk for children to walk up and down the street in front of the building?
So part of the easement, basically, if you're a pedestrian, this is the current sidewalk. And part of the easement that we're providing is a sidewalk easement, so that we can have a 7.5-foot sidewalk between the front door to the curb.
So the sidewalk is continuous.
Yeah.
And I think what I would suggest is some sort of either higher curb or bollard, something to stop somebody from pulling off onto the sidewalk.
Exactly. Usually we have the bollard with the sign sort
okay.
of sticking out of it.
Yes, sir.
My name is Robert Kiley from 34 Bull Street. And I haven't looked at the plans that close, but on the side facing our building, which if you're looking at this project, our building is on the right. Yes.
Okay.
Are you intending to build on the line?
What's our setback? What's our setback?
Yes, we have 1 foot
off of the property line.
Well,
on the first floor, upper floor is set back 5 feet.
Right,
I don't see how you're going to be able to build that and not have problems with the cars and our parking lot.
This is the existing fence line.
In our parking lot.
Your parking lot's unaffected.
Oh, okay. You're going to be able to build it without going on my property. Within the foot.
Yep.
Okay. A couple other things, as Wayne had mentioned before, the air handling units are going to be large for this size project. They're going to be running 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. Our building is approximately 12 feet from the property line. And where is the sidewalk going to be during construction?
Well, those two different questions that you want an answer about the HVAC equipment. Did you have a question about the mechanical equipment?
No, the sidewalk itself, is it going to be open because there's only one on one side of the street here?
Yeah. Okay. I think we have to basically work with the town to maintain pedestrian access and travel. And so we'll get to the point where we'll come to the town. And if we need to, I mean, likely we'll need to, because we have to do improvements along here as well. And so we'll either bump out and create a pedestrian zone where people can walk, where there's currently parallel parking, so we will lose some parking potentially during construction. Or we could direct people across the street and then go down and then potentially bring them back across. All those are things.
There isn't any sidewalk on the other side of Gould Street.
There isn't a sidewalk on the other side of Gould Street.
But we could, I mean, in the way that we develop that street edge, we can add our angled parking later so that we're phasing in the existing sidewalk, and we're keeping that active for as long as possible. And then once we've introduced our new setback, we'll be able to use that as a public way. So I think in the way that we phase the construction of that street frontage, we'll be able to manage the sidewalk effectively.
That's all coordinated with public safety during construction.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's definitely something that changes over the course of construction. We want to get off the street as fast as we can.
We'll have to submit a construction management plan
yeah.
showing exactly
yeah.
the movements
yeah.
and movements.
Right. Okay.
Thank you.
Well, somebody let's get everybody. No, it's you.
Wait,
that's here. Yeah.
Dave Walworth.
you mentioned the setbacks in the back of the building, which is 3 feet, and then on the right side, 3 feet, yep. Now that's just the setback to a wall.
Correct.
And then you mentioned the setback to the building, which is a little deceiving. And is there a setback on the right side too?
So
on the right side of the building.
Here, there's a setback.
No, I got that.
Okay.
Right where your hand just was, on the right corner.
1 foot.
Okay. What I'm trying to figure out is how, over the course of this process, you gave us a 3 foot setback in the back. You gave up space in the front, but yet you gained more parking spots.
Yeah. We shrank the organization of the elevator and the lobby. We've tightened up. If you look at the earlier plans, there was a much more generous lobby. There was a more generous elevator lobby as well. We compressed all that. We've actually shifted the location of the elevator floor, so it's more in the center of the floor plan. And that allowed us to pick up those additional parking spaces that are next to the trash area.
How wide are your spots?
You see this? See this whole area of construct, this whole, all these spaces?
Oh, right.
Those are all gone, six. Well, they've been moved
out. All got pushed in here.
How wide are your spots?
The compact spaces are six.
No, your regular parking spot.
Those are 8'6", I believe.
8'6". So if you go out in the parking lot of the town hall, the lines are 8 feet apart. And if you look at the way people park, it's tiny. It's not a parking spot. It's not big enough. And what we need to check too is with this new design, I know the town engineer had some concerns with the way it was angled in the width and the depth. I mean, I know you just caught this, so there's nothing you can do about it now.
No, I already asked him, and he's fine with it. He actually thinks the turning movements on this plan are better.
Okay.
Yeah, in the initial one we had, it was kind of there was not a very clear circulation pattern, but in the last meeting that we had, we adjusted it so it's a very clear one-way circulation inside of the parking garage now.
Mm-hmm.
We've also single-loaded all of the parking across along the back, the rear edge of the site. Before we had some parallel parking spaces inside the garage. So in this one, we have all front-loading with the exception of the angled parking space. So everything's a little bit easier to get in and out of. We've allowed for a little bit better clearance in the parking lane. And where we've lost space to accommodate all of that is with the building itself at the entry lobby.
Okay. The 5 spots out front don't count because you can't use them in the winter. You can't park on the street overnight in the winter.
I think.
Well, I'm just saying, just to take it out of your account, take it out of your account.
We haven't included it. Yeah, we didn't include it.
In the more current plan, it is not included.
It's not
in the
account. Okay.
Everything is inside the garage.
And then my next question is one of the rules in Reading is 20 units per acre. This site is less than 1 acre. And I'm trying to figure out how and why you as the developer would come in at 300% what the town recommends.
That's a
huge number.
So the 20 units per acre in the regulations were actually established because that's what Massachusetts law requires as a minimum. So during the process of developing this overlay district, that's what we set because we couldn't go any lower, and we didn't want to go any higher. But the reason why we didn't want to go any higher, because if we went higher, then someone could come in and I'll put it this way. Essentially, that meant that any relatively dense development would have to come and go through this process with us. So we didn't set that as a standard. We set it as a threshold, in which case developers would have to come and work with us to get a permit. We couldn't set it any lower because that's the way, that's the threshold that Massachusetts established.
My question was to Dave, though.
Hold on. Density is a little confusing, but the house next to you, 28, that's a three unit?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Do you have any issue with that being a three unit?
Do I have any issues with that being a three unit?
Does anyone in the neighborhood have an issue with that being a three unit? Okay, so that house sits on a lot that is 3,300 square feet. So do you know what the density of that lot is? 40 units per acre.
That house was built in
1920. Not the third floor. No. It probably wasn't
a
three unit.
It was very similar.
Okay, but understand
right.
What I'm saying about density. So that's 40 units per acre. But you wouldn't think it is. It's just a couple of apartments, three apartments, right? So I'm not saying that 100 units per acre is right, or 80 or whatever. I'm just trying to make you understand, what does that number look like, right? I mean, yours is like 26 units per acre. If you took the size of your lot, approximately, and it's two units, right? Two apartments. So that number is deceiving sometimes when you think about it. It sounds like a small lot. It's actually one of the bigger lots in the downtown.
Yeah, but I apologize, but the whole thing is why do we have the rule?
Because if we didn't set a minimum density of 20 units per acre, it does not qualify for the state law that allows 40R. Now, basically, that's the lowest number that we could include in the zoning and qualify for the state regulations.
Yes. But
no, go ahead, finish your thought.
So the buildings across the street from my house are 12 units on the same size lot as mine. What happens to that density? So
it's existing.
Talking about the
you can go back and forth.
Which one are you talking about? The brick?
Right. The brick ones that you don't like.
Mm-hmm. Well, but I mean the brick ones, the existing ones are completely non-conforming.
But what I'm saying is what's the density on those? Because there's three units on 28 Green Street,
yeah.
But there's 12 units across the street from me.
No, but that's you have to count all of the apartments in that area.
Well,
there's 96 units.
I don't know how it's broken up, but if you just took the footprint of the building and gave it 10 feet because they're spread out, the density would drop. So then I can play on my point. Of 20 units per acre.
Yeah,
those were existing prior to us expanding the 40R district. So if those get redeveloped, they're going to have to come in at least 20 units per acre. Already are.
I'm trying to remember what all the lots. There's two lots on that piece of property. One is like 0.7 acres and one is 0.9 or something.
Do you want me to pull it up?
It's 96 units.
This density, it's kind of relative. Like the minimum, I can see how you had a minimum. You can set us for a maximum. It was 0.2, but the one with 40 units per acre, that's 0.4. This, when we had 58 units, so divided by 0.7, that was 0.83. So you went from 0.4 to 2.2 to 0.4 now to around 0.8. So it is relatively up on the high end of the density.
It's less than 80 units per acre.
It's
now.
Like
yeah, 50, it's down drop.
It's like 55 or 57 units per acre.
57 divided by 0.7. It's about divided by
0.7.
No.
55 divided by 0.7 is right.
Yes.
78.
Okay.
I said 8.8. That's off.
Yeah.
2.9.
And it's come down.
Yeah, it's come down. It used to be above 20. Right.
Yeah, so it hasn't come down much. It's come down to 100s, which is a small fraction, a few percent. So it's relatively, it's a lot higher than everything else, I guess, would be my point.
Okay, that's a fair point, but that's what the zoning allows, the density, so that the project can be viable too. And we get our mixed use out of it, and we get our affordable units out of it. Those are the bonuses that they're getting. As long as they conform with the design guidelines and some of the other things we're asking for.
Well, if you're in the neighborhood, it's more activity, and it's different if your car is driving down the street. If I'm driving down the street, it doesn't impact me. If if it's a little less impact in the traffic study, but if I live there and I see cars going by, it's just a different perspective, I guess, for the people that are in the area. With more people in the area, it's it tends to driving the area to overcrowding. I see it like when I took the train to Boston, every stop in Wakefield, you see this big building being built out right at the train stop. You stop in Melrose, you see these other big buildings. And it used to be nice. I lived in Melrose a long time ago, too. But now you see these big structures that kind of stick out, and they kind of ruin the environment a little bit, the nature, the character of the town. So
well,
just think four stories is pretty much.
Yes, ma'am.
My name is Jeannie Sullivan, and I live on Blueberry Lane, so I don't have the same emotion attached, I guess, to this, but I still have a very high level of concern, and I think part of it is what you talked about. I'll be honest, I found what you said, I'm sorry, insulting to compare a 3-bedroom unit to a 50-plus unit and talk about density. I mean, and I don't live in that neighborhood, but that's a ridiculous comparison. I apologize, but it's unfair. This is a big building with a lot, and it's not the only one going up. So you've got a fairly crowded area already that it's hard to look at these traffic things in isolation because you've got more buildings going up, more people, and also I'm concerned that it didn't take into account that they'll be concerned about is the traffic from the retail establishments on the ground floor. That will be going, so you've talked about the residents, but and you said, oh, well, that won't matter because it's daytime. Well, it matters if you live in the neighborhood. It matters to me because I do business in downtown Reading. It matters to me as a business owner because I didn't put my business, I looked for space in Reading, and I went to Wakefield because of the parking, and that was a year and a half ago. So I wouldn't move my business back now to Reading. And anyway, I'm concerned about the density too.
Yeah, I wasn't comparing that building to this building. What I was trying to do is make someone understand what that density can be calculated as. And you look at that house and you don't think that's 40 units per acre. That's all.
I know, but it's a
understand
three
the parameters
house.
Between
it's
the two. It wasn't meant to be insulting, especially
to
them.
And to me, if I
okay,
lived
so
on
does
that
your
street,
traffic
I,
study
my blood is
include the counts from the retail?
I don't live there.
It's kind of insulting that you won't bring your business back to Reading. So your traffic study includes counts from the retail, does it not?
Motor vehicle trips, yes.
They're included in those numbers. I don't know why you think that they weren't.
I thought somebody asked you the question. Well, you also said that it's daytime and
yeah, but the traffic impact analysis study does include the motor vehicle trips, the commercial motor vehicle trips.
Well, you know, anyway, it's just if it's your house, do you want to have 17 more cars driving by your house? You probably don't want that, right? Or so 17 per hour, I don't know, it doesn't, you know, 60 a day, I don't know, 50, I don't know, there was like different numbers, I'm a little confused about that. I don't know. It was like 50 in the p.m., 38 a.m.
I can go over the numbers again.
I don't know. Anyway, even if it's just 17 a day, or 20 a day, or 50 a day, would you want 50 more cars driving by your door? Wouldn't.
And the reality is it's 17 from each of the projects, perhaps, too. So we're talking about
yeah.
just yours in isolation, but
no.
They're dealing with other projects that are going up that will also impact the
build out includes numbers from the other projects. That was the point of that projection.
Hi, I'm Rick Wetzler from 9 Gold Street. And I only have 16 points to make. But I'll make two and pass the rest around if I do. And the two I wish to make are, here's some stairs if anybody wants them. You folks in the CBPC are making a lasting impact on this project. One that will far outlive the time that the developers sell the building. And we in the neighborhood are going to be living with those impacts. Maybe it's our reduced property values if we're not quite so lucky as to have them elevated. Maybe some traffic points that are already raised. My concern is that you address first the massive scale difference that is coming up. I call this memo entering Reading City Limits, because you're in effect nudging us into citydom from towndom, and the livability that's Reading that makes it so special for us, to some extent, is being eroded by this. So I'm wondering what you can do in the design repertoire that will make it perhaps less daunting, less massive in scale. I understand you set the top floor back a little bit, but it seems like there are lots of examples of buildings that go a couple of steps further so that the scale is more in harmony with a residential neighborhood. And I just don't see that in the designs that I've seen up until the last meeting. Maybe it's evolved further. So my first point is, how are you going to make this more livable and honor the qualities of Reading itself rather than move us beyond where we've been in this livable city? And then the second point is the impacts of these other projects that you're dealing with all at the same time, Chaffetz Street, Haven, Lincoln Street. I would be surprised if your modeling may have overlooked some of the multiplicative factors when you add all that traffic and all that development. So there's a quality of life issue. There's also a fundamental planning with multiple projects at the same time. I thought about this as I was backing my car up at Market Street. At the same instant, somebody had gone into their car. We both backed up into the same area. We didn't hit each other, but it was one of those coincidences where if she had been a second earlier or a second later, I would have noticed her, she would have noticed me. But it's one of those coincidence and timing situations where planning does not often take it into account. So I'm wondering, with four such large projects going on at once, making some similar demands, how you might be addressing that. So the scale, livability, aesthetic quality, approachable from the street, what will you factor in? And then the other is this multiplier effect. I'd love to hear your thoughts on that. I don't know if there's plantings, if there's ways of lowering the net height of the building, if you absolutely need all those rooftop units and all the shadows that they're casting. That's my pitch. Thanks.
I'll just say a couple quick words. You know, our aesthetic sort of sensibility is being driven by a couple factors. Number one, that this was a commercial site, has commercial across the street from it, to the left and to the right of it. But it's mostly being driven by the desire to sort of pick up elements of the existing building that's on site. So that's like sort of the driving factor. The next sort of factor behind that was the design guidelines that are implemented as part of the smart growth. So it's very detailed up to the height of the awnings and exactly what, you know, sort of, and we're just working to comply with those. And we agree with a lot of them, to be honest, too. And we'll continue to work through the design process in terms of materials, and I mean, we've already made commitments, but we'll continue to work, you know, exactly what, you know, where things will be and how they'll be in place. But again, I think it's important to remember this was a commercial building, had, you know, workers here, has commercial element, you know, sort of elements of a more sort of manufacturing type of use, and that's what's across the street and to the right and left of us. We certainly recognize what Green Street is, and we hope that sort of the movements we've made towards articulation of the facade in the back and treatments and plantings and that kind of thing has been in direct response to our neighbors, who admittedly are going to be looking at it more than we are. And in terms of just the, you know, traffic analysis and whether it takes into account everything, I mean, there's 300 some odd pages of backup. I don't think I can really summarize all of them very well, but, you know, it's all been done to standards and sort of accepted principles.
My question about calling that an industrial site, if you look at the ARC site, it's a very livable, very small scale building, one story for the most part.
Yeah.
It's got texture to the color of the facing. The facade is actually quite warm. What you're mapping out is a large scale industrial cold cityscape, from what I saw in the first round of your plans. And I think that simply saying you're replacing an industrial building with an industrial scale building is not appropriate. What you see at the ARC, and I've lived across and seen every day for 27 years, is something that's wider, simpler, more welcoming, especially from Gould Street. Perhaps we're getting some plantings and green mitigation on Gould Street, but it looks to me like it's all going to Green Street. And I'm glad for Green Street, if whatever plants you put in. But I guess I question whether what we're seeing is a suitable scale as you walk up Gould Street, as I do daily.
Sorry, while we pull up the Gould Street rendering. So again, you know, we're talking about brick that mimics the brick that's on the site already. So in terms of the warmth that you're picking up off the brick, we agree, it looks great. That's something we're going to be mimicking and using. In terms of some of the window dimensions, same kind of thing. So you know, maybe our renderings aren't doing the justice, usually they don't. But in terms of material palettes, we're talking about brick, we're talking about sort of sandstone, which, you know, you can Google sandstone in terms of what it looks like, what does it feel like when you touch it. And so a lot of the materials that we're talking about that are already on site, we're reusing those. And so it, again, if the rendering doesn't pick up that warmth, I get it, but.
What about the heterogeneity? It looks like it's fairly uniform. Perhaps it's the scale that I'm looking at, but are you going to get that variegated feeling?
You get some texture. You can sort of see if you're up close, and you can see some of the texture that's in the brick. And you'll see, you know, the ins and outs of the buildings. That, you know, there's currently the building sort of zigs and zags all around the site.
And so those are things that we have to work on as well. It's going to be a process. Get it to this level of detail that we, you know, that looks like it. It's been there for a long time. The building's also based on traditional style architecture, where you have a base, a middle, and a top. And those are kind of reflecting the design guidelines that were set up. So this isn't a modern building that in the middle of the city. This is something that, like David said, comes from the design guidelines.
But this is traditional industrial architecture you're mimicking, is that right? As opposed to residential or something.
Not industrial, like commercial.
I didn't say that we were taking an industrial building and creating an industrial building. I'm saying we're picking up cues from a building that is not residential and using some of those cues in this building.
But you're putting it in a residential neighborhood with an industrial style roof line and fenestration that's not anything akin to the residences in the area. I'm wondering if you can make some deference to the local local residences in the neighborhoods that you're really impacted. And it's the fabric of these neighborhoods that, in effect, you're risking. When I left the last meeting, an old long-term friend of mine said the next day she was going to have her house appraised. This is somebody we really want to have in the town, somebody who's a stalwart anchor who's fully threatened by this development. I realize that this is not a NIMBY argument, and you guys have done a lot of excellent homework. The traffic site on your website is very detailed, as you pointed out. But I look at that structure, and perhaps I'm misgauging the renderings, but it just looks like it's going to echo the train and traffic noise. It looks like it's going to be a cold streetscape. I also wonder, just backing a car up onto Gould Street from your diagonal parking when there are snow drifts, what's going to happen. But I won't even go there. I just wonder what you can design further into this that will make it a less daunting scale, a more residential feel to it.
This site in particular is challenging. It's sure. In the many ways that you've identified, the mass of our building is really facing Gould Street. It's facing a commercial downtown area. It has characteristics that are more akin to what you may find in a commercial residential neighborhood, such as that. And so that's why we've maintained scalar elements such as a townhouse type scale to the way we've broken down the facade. We've allowed for an articulation developed about every 24 feet, so we don't have any long expanses at grade that are gonna be daunting. We've also introduced a lot of retail along the ground level street. And so what that's gonna do is also provide a setback for people to sit out, have a coffee. We have an amenable, pedestrian-friendly retail use there. That'll make it very lively, more than almost anything else the architecture can do. And then on the rear of the building, where it interfaces with the residential architecture, we have done a lot to introduce clapboard style paneling, as well as treat the windows so that they're sensitive to our neighbors. We've divided the facade so that we have the second and third floors read as a mass. We've lightened up the upper level to help break that up. And I think in the other renderings where we've shown views from the backyards, we've done a lot to introduce plantings as well as lowering the scale of that wall. So in every way that we've had an opportunity, we try to take advantage of introducing a more residential-friendly feel to the building. It is what it, I mean, and so I think with that, you know, it sort of has to balance these sort of two faces, the sort of residential Green Street facing, which has its architecture that we're showing here, and the commercial facing side of the building, which, you know, really is addressing a commercial downtown district.
It has some houses on it, Gold Street, including mine. Well, anyway, it's I guess, what would you call it, kind of post-industrial colonial?
we're hoping to call it a good neighbor, is what we're hoping to call it.
Wow.
Can you go back to the picture that you were just looking at, the picture of the front of the building? So, across the street, that little building on the corner that looks like it has awnings, but it really doesn't, that building right there, that's sort of it's very old, that's sort of a 2.5 story, I know it's a 3-story building, but it's really like a 2.5 funky looking story building. Your building is 4 stories. That picture makes it look like they're almost equal.
Right. Yes.
That building on the right is going to be so much bigger than the teeny building on the corner. That building on the corner is adorable. I've always wanted to like buy it and do it over and be cute. Because it is. It's historical, it's cute. But it's kind of run down. Your building is going to be way bigger than that building. So I feel like, and the building on the right is 2 stories, and it almost shows that it comes into this middle of your 3rd story. So this is deceiving. Your building is going to be huge.
That's the perspective. It's not.
I have an architect friend who's a landscape architect, and she said that's not true.
Your architect friend is wrong.
So what about a scale model that we thought we were getting this time, and we were getting it the last time?
I don't know. I didn't ask for a model. I did want to see the computer model, but
so I think you're reading the perspective correctly. And these are all when we did render these, they were rendered using the existing buildings with those dimensions. So everything should be in proportion in that image because it was all rendered from the same set of model information. And you're correct that this building on to the right of ours is actually a little over it's a little bit taller than 2 stories. It's about 24 feet tall, 26 feet tall, which is the brick building immediately to the right of our property. And that will be in the upper level of our second story as it's shown here. Again, the mansard roof building. I mean, what a lot of these buildings are helping more than anything else to provide us with is an additional palette of brick to look at, other ways in which we can begin to tie in other parts of the local design elements. And so, you know, that's something that's very much on our radar. We do want to be sensitive to the scale of the other buildings that are on the street. And honestly, those are things that are helpful for us as we're finding a strategy for developing the elevation and breaking down the mass of the building. Because we can look at things such as, okay, if we have something that's about a 24-foot wide townhouse type dimension, and we try to not have any elements that are more than 3 stories tall anywhere on the building, those are all things that help us to prevent this thing from reading as a 4-story building at any one moment. So if you look at the design a little bit closer, you'll see that we have really tried to break up the facade in such a way that we're not carrying any piece of it more than 3 stories.
My name is Barry Greenwood. I don't live in the neighborhood, but I am concerned, being a Reading resident for my entire life. the scale of this project is very big. One of my concerns, as an outsider, I came in a little bit late to the meeting, but I had heard about this and I was concerned just because I hate to see the town change at such an alarming rate. I understand real estate is hot, development is hot, people want to see things happen, people want to make money. If I'm very suspect that Green Street was never, a traffic study wasn't done. Granted, you did other intersections, the people that are going to be affected, those intersections absolutely should have been done. Shame on you. Second thing, I don't know if anyone's addressed the snow storage areas. I didn't see anything on the plan when you guys had it pulled up. It's a big snow year, 2015, piles of snow on that street, I remember, was 6 feet high. That was to get through that street. Again, I live on the other side of town, a mile away. Didn't affect me, but it affected everyone in that neighborhood. Very tough. The spaces that you guys showed listed as all compact cars, obviously wanted to squeeze more parking spots in to that configuration. 6.5 feet, just can't fly.
Not six and a half. The
compact cars?
Compact are 7.5 by 16.
Oh, 7.5, okay. What is the standard room? Right. The town must have a standard parking space. 9 by 18 is typical.
I think it's 8.5
for a
by
compact?
18
not
for a regular space.
Just take the compact
space
out of it. Just what is it, a standard parking space?
Because everyone drives an SUV in red.
Well, yeah, but
eight.
No, yeah.
I think
no,
it's 8.5 by
18. Look at that. You just have to look at it realistically. So when I came in and I saw this plan and I saw all these compact spaces listed, you could say, oh, that's we're being environmentally conscious. Well, that really wasn't the case. To me, it seems like we're trying to squeeze more cars on a plan that don't really work.
8.5 by 17.
Units. 8.5 by 17.
Is there standard space in an enclosed garage?
So if we discounted the compact spaces, we'd be losing, as you said, Nick, how many spaces? If you put the real dimension on?
Well, you're not going to lose all the compact spaces.
You're not going to lose all of them, but right now it's disproportionate on that plan that I saw. And again, this is the first time I saw the plan. I was just more surprised with how it was drawn.
And I think we have the potential to, even in our latest iteration of getting 69 spaces, that we have the potential to relax some of those compact spaces that are so tightly packed. We may be able to have two of those probably go back to a full-size space. And I think that we can get down to a number that's going to be acceptable in terms of what the balance of compact versus regular spaces are. And you're right, there are a lot of, you know, parking spaces in this carport. But that's also in sort of a response to the, you know, trying to achieve the number that the city's looking for the density of housing to the density of parking. And so, you know, it's a balancing act. But, you know, this is a managed building that's rental. And so we'll have a certain amount of control over what types of tenants are leasing, who's, what type of car they're driving perhaps. And they may not want to rent a place that has a compact space if they drive a big SUV. They may be more of a compact car driver. So there's going to be a certain level of self-selection that's going to develop with the way that the car parking occurs. And I think Dave had some excellent data up on the screen that was showing what the pattern of usage is with the other properties that are managed. And it seems to be that that's well within a comfortable range of usage. With the number of spaces that we've shown.
Just to reiterate, snow storage, so all of this site, with the exception of the setbacks that are around the property, will, the roof will catch snow. So there's no, you know, obviously there's the sidewalk, but the sidewalk's already there. But in terms of any snow that falls on this property will fall on the roof surface, it'll melt, it'll go into the recharge, and that's it.
But what about allowing for snow storage on the in the paved area?
From where?
There's no paved area.
Nothing.
There's no unenclosed paved area.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's truly a garage. It's covered.
Okay.
Please. Wade Wilworth again. The front line of this building is 200 feet. And if you go to the Haven Street project that nobody likes in town because of the color and all that, go to the back of that building and look at the back of that building, because that is that building right there. It's 200 foot long. That's 200 foot long.
I'm sorry.
Haven Street's
200 foot. I'm not going to agree with you on this one because that facade is flat and this is not flat.
Yeah, but if you step back something 2 or 3 or 5 feet, the structure, the massive structure is still there. This is what, you know, this all this density and all this other stuff. This is 200 feet along the street. And if you go behind.
It's not the same. It's not perceived anywhere near the same. You can't.
How can you not say that? It's four stories.
I can't say that.
Haven Street's 240 foot long.
I understand that the length is the same.
Okay.
But our guidelines specifically make him break that up every 30 or 24 feet, which they've done. You will not perceive that as what you've seen on the back of in the back of the Haven Street project. You won't.
It's still a massive structure. You're setting something back a foot or two.
No, that's not a foot.
No.
So
five,
those
five
are
feet,
totally not connected.
What?
Like, that makes no sense. So the building itself.
Okay, so let's talk about the Haven Street project because you all recognize that.
Right.
That building on the Haven Street side is not perceived for how tall it is because you're usually only catching the top of the third floor because of the setback and because of the hole in the middle of it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So you're really just catching those two ugly pink, admittedly, ugly pink pieces, but you don't get that full height. Because you can never see the top of that top story. Unless you're way back, and then you're not seeing the whole building.
He was talking about looking at it from the back of the building, from the parking
looking at it from the back of the building.
But, and what I'm saying is that the back of the Haven Street building is definitely not the front of this building.
I disagree. So.
Okay, well, it's not.
Okay.
And that's my professional opinion.
And Gene Sullivan here. And the thing about the 30 Haven Street is that a little bit more isolated. There's the big parking lot.
And that's why they were allowed to do that, because while there is residential behind that building, it is way off.
Right.
And there's also the drop in grade from Woburn Street to the parking lot,
mm-hmm.
which makes that thing seem down. And so they did it with material rather than setbacks.
So
they're not doing that.
Right, it's big, but it's got more space, parking lot space around it, and it's all retail. Where this. And what I keep hearing is it's size, it's number of cars, and it's size, that this is a fairly big building to be smooshed onto that piece of land. And, you know, and I get it that this is the rendering, but, you know, so it's all looking at the scale. It's going to look like a big building in relationship to what else is there, particularly for Green Street, because it's going to just tower over them, whereas 30 Haven towers over a parking lot.
Right. And there's, sorry, you see it for me. And 30 Haven has a lot of room on either side of the building and several entrances and exits to that area where this, you've got, you know, it's just jammed up against every building that surrounds it and the homes behind it, whether it's 7 feet set back.
No economic sense. The developer has to buy the property for a certain amount of money. And if they buy that property, which, keep in mind, if they don't, lays vacant without anyone doing anything, maintaining the outside, letting it become dilapidated. If they buy that property, they cannot make their purchase price back with 25 units. It's simply not economically viable. So your alternative is a building that will sit there without anyone buying it because it doesn't make economic sense. So that's the neighbor that you would
use. Somebody is in the building already, is arranged to rent the property though.
Excuse me, what?
Somebody is already arranged to rent.
They don't pay any property taxes.
Yeah, but Dave said that HVAC guy was going to buy it and he didn't, and he kept saying like, would you have an HVAC guy there? And we were like, yes, we would, because he's a 9-to-5 guy, and he would keep the building low, and it would be great. And we love blue-collar workers in Reading. We love you, too. But we love blue-collar workers. So why not? The whole thing here is everybody's saying it, including the CPDC, is that we don't have enough parking in the parking garage. We don't like the height. Why not get rid of those couple units, get all those great parking spaces, put a couple awnings on it, make it look cute, and then make it a go. And I think you'll still make some money, but go to bed and sleep at night and be, give one to the team. You know? Might make a little less, but we'll be so happy.
Because it would be economically viable for all of the citizens of Reading. My name is Don Greenwood. And they're trying to say, your journey to do is better for the whole town, but at the cost of humans that have lived here their whole lives or care about their area. And I am appalled that you're not looking at the height. This is disgusting to me to look at. Where we are in Melrose, two of these have gone up across from me and next to me. And I am already a two-story building, a four-story building across from me. It used to be this gorgeous field. We're in development. Totally understand why people want to make money. Four units above. Huge. It is got lots of space around it. There's no houses around it. It is still daunting. So you're absolutely wrong to say that this is not crammed into an area that has houses behind it, commercial property in front of it. And I'm in a commercial area. I expect development to happen where I am in Melrose. That goes on the back side of Oak Grove. If anyone has driven on Washington Street, you can see this is exactly what I look at every single day out my window. It is huge. At my work, at my office, I look at that. It's huge. Come sit with me. That is not a tiny four-story building. It's identical, the size and everything.
Charlie Adams, 13 Riverside. So I guess I'll be the lone voice in the wilderness. I think we're here tonight because we did pass this as a smart growth area, and that's why this is... this is what we want as a town, I think, for the uses of this downtown area to encourage, economic development. You know, today that's really what this is about. I mean, Rachel, to your point, is that, I know it's stressful for people and I know that there's some concerns about it, but I think the design has been pulled, it's a building that works off of Gould Street. It's trying to do that. And it's the smart growth. This is what we want. And we want people to come into the downtown. We want to encourage TOD development. We want ground floor retail. We want the people that are going to be in this building are going to be, net positive benefits for the town. It's not going to be a drain on town resources. People are going to be coming in here. They're going to be having disposable income. They're going to be spending on the shops and the restaurants and creating this downtown vibrant area that we want. And with respect to the parking, I'm always of, as Dave said, if you build it, they will come. I mean, ultimately, at the end of the day, it's the developer's issue about how much parking is there. And if there's not enough parking, it's a marketability issue for him. So I understand that there are concerns about having a ratio of 1.25. At the end of the day, that's really his issue to deal with. He's got to be able to lease these units. And if he's comfortable that there's enough parking there, then that should be good and that should be sufficient. So.
Andrew?
I'm all for smart growth, and I totally believe it. To me, this is
getting some
smart.
New voices.
Thanks. Hi, I'm Andrew Corona, the economic developer for the town. It's no secret. I just want to provide a little bit of context and for consideration from an economic development perspective. It's no big secret that the town of Reading, not unlike many of our peer communities, deals with budgetary constraints and issues nearly constantly from day to day. Largely, these are driven from past obligations and pensions, rising health care costs. In addition to this, town revenue is limited to 2.5% annually per Proposition 2.5. Essentially, what this means is the town runs a budget deficit, and that until an override is passed, which bridges the budgetary delta temporarily, illegally alleviating the financial situation, we're just kicking the can down the road. Significant structural changes have been implemented in an attempt to be as responsible to the various and often conflicting desires of Reading's diverse residents, but it's not enough. A failed override vote was an indication of the desire of residents that the taxes not be raised. That said, there has been overwhelming pressure on the town to continue to provide the same high level of quality service to its residents. I've used this example in the past. Let's make a deal, the game show, where door number one would be an increase in taxes. Door number two is a reduction in the level of services provided to the town residents. And door number three is economic development. Towns like Concord willingly choose door number one and they consistently pass overrides. Others choose door number two and they lay off teachers, they lay off police officers and firefighters, they stop filling in potholes, and essentially they reduce their public safety efforts. Smart investment in the town is important if we're going to provide the same level of high services to our residents without passing an override year after year. Economic development is the common sense compromise that residents deserve. This project is a place where people will live, where people will shop, a place where residents will go to work, and it will look a lot nicer than what's on the project currently. The color of a building, the shadow, or an irrational fear of parking shortages aren't sufficient to kill this project, because it makes sense for the 25,000 residents of the town. Residential parking is self-selecting. If prospective tenants have a need for two or more spaces, they will choose developments that offer those, or they'll pay to have an additional space. The town enforces parking. It's not as if you can park on the street for more than 2 hours without getting a ticket in that zone. Residential parking demands also dovetail nicely with the commercial downtown uses, with a substantial drop during business hours when the commercial demand is the highest. Our most recent parking study revealed that peak parking demand in the downtown area is around 60%, well below the recommended 85% utilization rate. Since their original submission, Trigora Development, through a friendly, collaborative effort, has generously increased their parking and modified plans to allow for a ratio of 1.25 versus the original one. I've heard in the past that residential development carries with it a higher strain on town finances by way of school costs, and while I think that avoiding this type of development is entirely misguided, as I believe the younger populations are the ones that bring with them the vitality and energy that's the envy of every community throughout the country with deteriorating populations leading to blight, it's also false. Not all residential developments created equal. Multifamily and mixed-use developments have a disproportionately low burden on the school system when compared to single-family. We have that data to prove it. In the previous town meeting, members overwhelmingly, if not unanimously, voted to expand the 40-yard overlay district. This zone allows for mixed-use developments and was a recommendation of the 2015 Economic Development Action Plan completed by MAPC. This is because these well-designed districts can create a distinctive sense of place and fulfill market demand for walkable neighborhoods, reducing development pressure on outlying areas, and minimizes traffic impacts. This additional use has effectively increased property values in the downtown, as evidenced with recent interest and activity. Long before the adoption of the 40-yard zone, 45 feet was the allowable height in Business B, and the client's not asking for a waiver there. 40-yard developments also allow for the town to have input into the design phase like we are now, which results in a more desirable project. The difference between this and a 40B, which is that the town has no ability to restrict those until we meet our subsidized housing inventory goals. I recently read an article in the Boston Globe about a boutique pizza restaurant that essentially chronicled the challenges the operator faced obtaining a permit from the Cambridge ZBA, and it read, "Municipal boards play important roles, from planning and zoning decisions to historical and environmental preservation safeguards. But too often, they are hyper-responsive to the loudly stated wishes of the relative handful of people who show up to meetings to complain. Meetings devolve into something approaching satire, where everyone is suddenly an expert in market research, architecture, interior or graphic design, and the sacred history of a place. History is defined as wherever point in time they remember most fondly. I know a lot of you and have a lot of respect for the CPDC board. We as a town need to act in the best interest of every single Reading resident, all 25,000 of them, and not be deterred by a vocal minority in opposition of smart developments that benefit the whole town in a variety of ways. And it's for this reason that I think this is a great project for the town, and I would encourage CPDC to approve it."
I'm glad you're a town employee.
I Do you live in that?
You gonna stop?
I don't.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah. Do you want this next to your house?
Excuse me.
Great.
Excuse me.
My house is more.
Jonathan.
Hi, Jonathan Barnes. I live at 41 Pratt Street. Actually, I want to just ask a question first, and I have a comment. In terms of the process, Nick, I heard some. We've had some back and forth about the design elements and tweaking the design elements and your or CPDC's ability with respect to those design elements. What exactly are the steps or the processes, or what exactly is your input with respect to those changes that Dave and this developer are incrementally making here? Do they make whatever changes they want, or do you tell them what this design is going to look like?
This is the process. We're doing it right now.
So you tell them what this design is going to look like?
No.
That's what I'm asking.
I mean, it's been ongoing about three or four meetings in a row.
There's a
proposal from the developer. We discuss it. We discuss possible changes. They go back, they make sense out of the suggestions, and they bring a modified proposal before us.
Okay.
And it's this iterative thing which is going on right now.
Okay.
But starting from the beginning, there were design guidelines. And so if they use, and if there's something in those design guidelines that they aren't going to comply with, don't want to comply with, can't comply with, that's where they need to come and get waivers from those design guidelines. In general, most of the design part of the design guidelines, the building part, the architectural part, they have all complied with. I think I'm on with that.
Seeking waivers for any of the design.
Yeah. Yeah.
But what I'm asking is, at the end of the process, whenever that is whatever they have presented to you and to us and to the town who are watching, is that design going to be approved by you, and is that design what actually gets built?
The decision would be based on the latest set of documents they've presented.
Okay.
And lessons learned from 30 Haven, I would want to write something in there that made them come before us again with their final material decisions, so we don't get saying they're
right
out of the brick.
And I know we talked the last time about the minor modifications that I had raised before. I get that. But I guess what I'm trying to say is, in terms of where it sounds like everybody is, I'm not exactly clear where you all are, nor am I clear where you are. But this is the latest proposal, and honestly, you have made significant modifications to it to address what a lot of the residents and what a lot of other people have said. You're going to be commended for that. I really appreciate the movement that you've made. I'm sure a lot of these folks appreciate some of the movement that you've heard. But where I am right now in terms of this is that I haven't heard necessarily whether or not you're going to present something different at the next meeting. I haven't heard whether or not the CPDC members are interested in having you present anything different or not. It sounds as though a lot of folks here are interested in that. And Andrew, with all due respect, I don't think anybody is necessarily, well, I shouldn't say anybody isn't, but most people here are not looking to scuttle this project. It's not a question of whether or not a project will be done on this parcel. And we get that it has to be economically feasible, but I guess what I'm getting at is that this process really, I mean, we're all providing input to try to shape what you push this developer to and what this developer pushes himself or themselves to. And what I'm trying to ascertain is what is he being pushed to, what are they being pushed to come up with the next time? And I'm not clear that I'm getting any real, that we're getting any real direction from you as to what that is. And I ask that because the concern, I think, is, after everybody expresses their point of view, that we're going to get to a meeting where they're not going to come up with anything different. And it may be the next meeting, I don't know. And you all are going to have to decide whether or not to approve it. And I guess all I'm saying with respect to that is, if this is going to continue to be a process where the plan, the project is a little bit different and moving in a certain direction at the next meeting, I'd like to know that. But my fear is that it's going to be a little tweak here, a little tweak there, and you all are going to be approving it or not approving it, but I'm sure you're going to be approving it. So I'm trying to ascertain, within the realm of economic feasibility to the developer, where is the area that the developer is being moved to? He's probably not being moved to reduce a floor, but maybe he's being, or will be, will see his way to recessing it back on the fourth floor. You talked about how that project is recessed back, Haven Street, 30 Haven Street. You don't see it, the fourth floor from the front, because it's stepped back. Postmark Square is stepped back on the third and fourth floor. In fact, on the second floor off the project. It is stepped back in the back to some degree, and you've stepped it back further, I agree. I guess the question is, are you gonna step it back a little further in response to this? Is this the end of the process? Is CPDC gonna look to move you to step it back a little further? The process, this public process, is incremental steps that the developer moves to change the project. And I guess I'm asking, how close are we? Are we still moving or is it not moving? Thank you.
So, I think we could all talk about the process all night. In retrospect, what we've done is we've been here, we started with the design guidelines, we've come to the meetings, we've talked to you all ahead of the meetings, we've come to the meetings, gotten the feedback, built the feedback that we've heard, everything that we've heard, into the next iteration. The design guidelines, I mean, we don't want to seek waivers. So this, from the perspective of not seeking waivers, complying with the handbook that we are given that's voluminous, we want to comply with that. That's what we're doing. If tonight, we have made a lot of concessions, a lot of pushbacks, and, you know, they're more than just incremental. These are big percentages off of units, off of, you know, setbacks, we're prepared to do that. I mean, in terms of the facade and the materials, we have no problem, and we would do this regardless of whether the CPDC wanted to or not. Sit here and say, we'll bring a materials board to our neighbors meeting, and we'll talk about it. We'll bring it here, and we'll talk about it. Because I agree, I don't want everyone to walk by my building and say, that is the ugliest building in Reading. I don't want it. And that's not what we're gonna build. We think that based on the current design guidelines, we can build an attractive building. That's our intention. If there's another step in terms of coming back once this is further along, we're happy to do that. But at some point, we do need, we need a vote. And we need to keep this project moving and continue working on this. But if we don't get a vote, we're not going to make more incremental changes because we won't be around.
Jonathan, I think one thing that might be throwing people off is the corner of the building. Because if you look beyond the tower, if you will, there's a setback above the three-story mark. So each one of those little row house pieces has a space between it. And I'm not here to defend their design, but I'm just trying to explain what's happening there. Those three-story townhouse pieces, if you will, all have spaces between them. There's a break, right? So you're getting that piece, then the next one, then the next one. And then there's a large recess behind between them that's what, 10 feet or even more?
5 feet, it should be over 5 feet.
And then above that, there's the setback on that fourth story. Now, what I think is happening here is though that this corner doesn't have a setback on it, and there's a lot, it's very visible. I think you might just have to do something to that top story piece there to break that up. I know you want to present a strong corner and hold it, but I think that that just presents itself as too monolithic, and it's not being understood. Mm-hmm. And then there's a, the retail piece in front of it, which is actually forward, and then that whole tower is set back to you. So you might have to change either the material or do something on that corner is what I was going to recommend.
Well, there. I happen to like the strong corner, but that's me.
In the design guidelines, there's two options. One is where you, the first story is one story high, and then you step back the rest up. And then the opposite of that is you can go from the street up to the third story and then step back. So those are the two things that we played with along the facade. So we varied that. So you'll see that in a few places. For example, the corner does that where it's on the first story.
Right. Yes, in the back.
To those points, those trees look like they'd be serving suggestions that would very quickly turn brown. It's a totally block sun exposure. So unless you've got really shade tolerant trees or giant grow lamps, I would encourage you to go the one and then three set back versus three up and one set back, just from the standpoint of getting anything to grow on that north side of the building. But you are probably more familiar with that sort of thing.
Actually, to that point, are we getting street trees? Do we have room for street trees along there?
But not if their light is blocked entirely. Grow.
It's western light.
Street trees can grow in this orientation. I mean, they do all over, and we'll pick the right. We'll work with the town to pick the right species of tree.
Hope it's not simple.
Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Nilo Pennings, 38 Belmont Street. I have a question relating back to the economics explained so clearly by Andrew. Has anybody come up with what the impact on the schools are going to be on all of the developments combined? I mean, you can't say there's going to be no impact. Is it two classrooms? Is it three classrooms? I mean, I will be taxed right out of Reading if we have to build another school, or if we have to, you know, so what is the, I know you're talking about it in the sense of economics, so what is the number that all of you have come up with all of these buildings combined? Has anybody come up with a number, or is it just kind of like, oh, it's going to be fine?
I don't know what the total number on the total potential build out is. How many units is the total potential build out? It's not really relevant to this project,
just
however.
Just approved 98.
We do have some data that we've looked at on previous mixed and multifamily developments that we can use as a barometer for what we could expect, but it just is going to depend on who decides to live there. But generally speaking,
but you must have, I mean, we can't really allow these giant buildings to come into Reading without analyzing what the impact on the schools are. I mean, that makes no sense to me.
But it's not 100 fifth graders.
I understand that. I mean, I'm not stupid. I understand that.
Because it's not going to be 100 fifth graders.
I'm not saying that. I'm just saying.
No, someone questioned it, I think. Someone said, how can you say that? Because it's likely to be some sort of blend. And even then, these units don't attract that many kids.
I think more of the concern relative to infrastructure is what was discussed at the Board of Selectmen's meeting, Nick. And that was specific to the need for more fire and more policing, because they have the numbers, certainly the police chief, the fire chief, provided the numbers that indicated the new projects, including Reading Commons, Walters Brook, and so on, including Addison Wesley, had high spikes for the number of calls for fire.
That's
I
did hear him say that, and I wish I hadn't left the meeting before he said that, because what I wanted to know from him was, he stated that some buildings were getting more calls than others, and I'm wondering if the Addison Wesley one is the plus 55 that's getting it.
That I don't
know. That's a very different animal.
And he did indicate that some of them were relative to equipment for fire alarms not working properly.
Correct.
That there were more calls relative to ambulance, and he said, you got to remember, when they call us out, you've got three vehicles at the very least. You've got, if somebody falls, you've got an ambulance, you've got a fire truck, and you've got a police car. So,
so
if
younger
you do
people
that,
would be a lower.
Well, no, I mean, but they were getting calls because the alarms weren't working, right? There's going to be, you can't say that there won't be an increase in calls, but I think that the economic analysis we've ever done with all these projects has always shown that there's still a net positive.
Barry Berman, one of the selectmen in town. And I just want to kind of talk a little bit about not so much this project and the impact that this project is going to have, but just sort of the rationale behind why are we even trying to do this? We looked at our ourselves in the mirror and said, well, what kind of a town are we in terms of comparing ourselves to some of our peer towns? And this is a fact. On average, of the 25 peer communities that we look at, Reading brings in $12 million a year less in commercial and industrial tax dollars than our peers. We're bringing in $5 million a year in commercial, industrial, and the average for our peer is $17 million. Okay, so right off the bat, there's $12 million of tax revenue that we're not bringing in because we don't have the commercial and industrial properties to do that. So we looked at it and said, okay, well, we're not going to be Burlington or Woburn. We're not that. We're Reading. So we looked at kind of where are our opportunities. We're not going to build lot line to lot line. We're not going to tear down neighborhoods. We're not going to, I said it before, we're not going to turn Bedford Falls into Pottersville. That's not what we're doing. But we are going to maximize the impact of where we can. And so we studied this, got a grant to do it, and we looked at four sort of development opportunities. One is the Smart Growth District, sort of downtown. And it's really, really important to talk to any of the downtown business owners. It's Deadsville during the day. Why? Because 80% of the people who live in Reading, work out of Reading. So it's really important to create people who live and work downtown. That was the impetus of doing the 40R. And so that's why these gentlemen are here, because we basically opened the door to allow that kind of stuff to happen. And the market is sort of coming to bear. And trust me, you'd rather have this project, Gould Street, a 40R, than if it was a Lincoln Street at a 40B. Because if it was a 40B, we wouldn't be here right now, and we'd be stuck with what we have. So that was one of the development opportunities. The other development opportunity is along South Main. Another development opportunity is some of that land behind RMLD. And one of the biggest ones is New Crossing. We're now working with the town of Wakefield. By the way, first time in the history of the Commonwealth that two towns were working together to create a shared use and try to take that to Camp Curtisgill, which would then open up a tremendous amount of development opportunity where nobody lives, by the way. So, you know, you talk about, what do you think could go in there? A hotel, another kind of, you know, Walker's Brook too. You can have all kinds of commercial opportunity, which is now gonna move the needle to get us closer to that $12 million of revenue that we're not collecting, okay? So what's the alternative? Well, we can just keep doing override after override after override, which basically, as a selectman, I'm tired of having to go to the community and ask for that. But the other choice is, well, we're just going to cut services. So anything that we're going to do, right, any kind of commercial development is going to bring in more revenue than what it's going to cost. As far as how many school children it's going to bring, you know, we can look at some of the past data. And look at what some of the developments have brought in, but you know, you can't say we don't want any more people coming into Reading to go to school. It's illegal as well as immoral. So we all came here because we like the schools. Other people are going to come here and do that too. But the bottom line is, if you look at Postmark Square and you look at the development that these gentlemen are proposing, the lion's share of them are one bedrooms, right? It's going to be marketed to people who probably work downtown, who are younger, who may come in town, kind of kick the tires, live in here, and say, you know what, when we get married, I'd like to buy a house on the west side, or I want to buy a house on Haverhill Street, right? So they will come and they will, you know, go move into these apartments and then maybe stay, right? So there's a rationale for doing what we're doing. Is it going to have an impact on people? Absolutely. I feel for folks. If it were in my neighborhood, I would be here at this meeting too. And I'd be asking questions and I'd be holding people accountable. But at the end of the day, that's what the zoning says and that's what they're allowed to do. They're not going higher than what the zoning allows. You know, the parking, I hope they can work on some of those other kinds of things, but it's going to be done within the context of what the zoning allows. Our job is to make sure that that's the best possible project it can be. Same with we did with Postmark, which got approved here. So, you know, we're not doing this, and someone said, oh, you just want to do this and make money. Well, you know what? If the town doesn't bring any more revenue, right, then the only way that we can get the money for the services is to come back to you every 3 years and ask for an override. Now, that doesn't mean that when we do this, overrides are going to go away, but they're going to be less frequent and they're going to be less severe. It's just the kind of balancing of the town that, you know, that what we want. We're not going to turn this into a city. It's still going to be the tree-lined, leafy streets that we've all come to know and to love, but we're just going to try to maximize the opportunity, because if we don't do it, you know, then we're left with either cutting services or raising taxes year after year. And that's something that obviously no one wants to do. So this is one project. These are the folks that are going to litigate it, right? You know, you've brought your questions to them. They're going to hold this gentleman accountable, and it's going to be the best project that we can do. But that's the rationale of why we're doing this the way we are. And trust me, I understand. If it was in my neighborhood, I would be nervous too. But, you know, yeah, I mean, it's not what it is. It's going to be, you know, it'll be something that the best that we can do. But, you know, that was, town meeting said we want to create a vibrant downtown, and it changed the zone. This is the result of it. And so, you know, let's work with the process and try to make it as best as we can. But that, I just wanted just to talk about, you know, why we're even looking at this and where this fits into the general scheme of things, and why it's good, you know, for the town.
I think I just need to move on just a little bit here. This these setbacks were presented tonight, and I guess the residents hadn't seen them yet. Did you look at them while they were up there? I mean, is it, who's here from, I know 26 is here, is 18, 20, 28, or 32 Green Street here?
I'm 30. 20 is they took
the
relevant,
and so I'm there. Okay. So, and what do we think about these modifications that they've made back here?
Can I ask a question about the modifications?
Sure.
You guys have no balconies. I know you probably think I'm obsessed with balconies, but kind of am, just because the sliding doors and somebody coming out and just the talking and the coming down the middle of that person. Are there any verandas? I'm going to use all the words. Are there any sliding doors where someone can come out of their apartment and walk around outside?
No.
None.
None facing you.
None facing the side of the door, none facing my neighbor's house.
Yeah, we will have terrace okay. Entrance to the terrace. Courtyard that's here.
Okay,
but
so terrace is it? What is a terrace?
Terrace is a deck that is more like a patio.
Okay, so these two
balcony hangs off the wall.
Okay, so on the second, third, and fourth floor, will people be able to walk out of their sliding glass doors outside?
No.
At all?
No.
No.
So how do they get onto the terrace?
That's only on the second floor.
You
said,
okay.
So the third,
so
sorry,
yeah, so we have that common courtyard. That's the only part that's accessible on the second floor.
Okay. So that 3,000 square foot common area, that is directly behind my
anything that shows the garden.
That's where they'll be able to come out.
But we've introduced this 15-foot setback. So this 15-foot zone here will not be accessible to the public, and will be plantings that will be managed by the building.
Yeah, I get that. I appreciate that. But that area, so if I have two different answers the last time, I just want to make sure. We talked about lighting last time. I don't know if there's any changes to lighting. We talked about public use, and I get that. Keep getting different answers. Are people going to be able to have a private function out there? You said we'll shut it down at a certain time of night. I mean, these are the things that once this is completely approved, we get to talk about, because in the middle of the summer, you know, a function out there of 40, 50 people is going to be 10 feet, well, 15 feet, whatever, across from my own deck. It's just a ton of noise, and I'm just making absolutely sure about the verandas and the things like that. So the people on the third and fourth floor, and I don't even know why you don't fill in that area with apartments and just take off that fourth level. So I'm going back. But that would be
That'll be much worse.
Yeah, you would not like it too much. Okay, so it's not going to be any worse than your neighbor filling up their yard to have a cookout, though.
There's two of them that live next door, and a couple of little kids on the other side, so it is going to be 140 to 160.
Okay, look, I'm sorry, I should have said one's neighbor.
Right.
Okay. Well, your yard actually has a decent, you have a nice piece back there that you want to talk about making it to like a back bay kind of garden thing.
Right. Anyways, all right, so that was my question. Was
about
balconies and verandas,
because
every time we talk about it, it's weird.
Did you get an answer?
Can I just summarize?
Yeah, that'd be great.
So you can see in this rendering, basically, we have all windows, and the only place where somebody can walk out from their unit is on the second floor to this shared courtyard. Some of the courtyard is for the whole building, and some of the courtyard is just for the people who it's immediately right outside of. Okay, so the courtyard is going to be divvied up. The middle section is going to be the shared area, and the areas along the units, because you don't want people right at your window, will be for that particular unit. So the only area where you can walk out from your unit to someplace outside of your unit is on the second floor units that come into the shared courtyard. Every other place on this Green Street facade is a window.
How did they access the public area?
They through a common, there's the sure, floor plan, but there's a common door. So if you're in the hallway.
The people in the whole building can
sorry.
Go whenever
exactly.
they want. Okay.
Not whenever they want. We shut it down at night.
What time?
Probably 10 o'clock. We can talk
That's
about
That's what
it.
You wanted to know.
Yep.
Yep, which is what we've said.
Originally, there were lots of verandas.
Yes, there were a lot of verandas. There were a lot of Juliet balconies.
Will there be tables and chairs out there, or
yep.
picnic areas,
yep.
fire pits?
Just like your next door neighbor.
Just, you know, I don't know about fire pits, but definitely picnic tables and umbrellas and flowers and, you know, all the stuff you have in your backyard.
May I please, Pamela Adrian, may
I
please...
I don't think it's funny. It's not funny. It's kind of rude. Go ahead.
May I address the waiver that is for trees, and I think I sent to Julie. A trees presentation, just wanted to just quickly put
a waiver for trees?
Trees, yes. There is a waiver for cutting down trees.
That's correct.
But I just wanted to bring it to your attention, and I sent that to Julie. And I just wanted to show you what you're looking at in terms of what gets cut down. That's all. It's very quick.
I think we know what it is, but let me...
Right.
I saw
Eight
the picture,
trees.
Too. Let me ask you a question.
Right.
You bought a house.
Yes.
That was not well maintained.
Right.
And you see these sometimes. The trees are growing right up against the
He's
okay,
not talking
no,
about
no,
your
no,
house.
No, no, no.
You're
no,
saying.
No. I fully understand that. All I'm saying is the waiver, as it was requested by Trigor, said we want a waiver to cut down trees. I wanted to make sure you understood that what you're talking about is 8 shade trees. That's all. 8 shade trees. And in its place, he's proposing arborvitae, is that how you pronounce it? I would suggest that probably should be shade trees, because no robin builds a nest in arborvitae. You understand?
I mean, they might have some shade trees up on the deck, but I don't see how
but
you could put a shade tree onto
the
deck.
So can I just talk, this is what
right.
we said at the beginning, but these trees are built up against the foundation, right?
Yeah.
And so when we remove that foundation
yep.
and we set the new wall 3 feet behind that, or in some cases 7 feet behind that,
right.
because they've been built up against the wall, chances are they actually might survive. You know, where you run into issues is where you have a tree that's out in the open, right? And you put in a foundation 3 feet from the trunk, and that tree's gonna die. Okay?
We recognize that.
Where we can, we're gonna not cut down trees.
Okay.
And more than likely, because of the setbacks that you all have gotten from us and we've given you, that those have a chance of living. And we're also putting in street trees along Gold Street.
Okay.
So, you know, our intention is not to cut down trees, but where we have to, we're going to have to.
Well, certainly within the perimeter
yes.
where the building is, there are 4
exactly.
or 5 trees there.
There's one here, and there, you know, there's some nice trees. I give you that.
Right.
So how are we going to How are we going to quantify which ones are potentially staying? Are we just going to have a general statement like it's written in here to allow certain trees to be removed?
I think we, you know,
6-inch caliper required to preserve.
We've just asked for a blanket waiver because you get into this and you just don't know.
I know. I want to make sure that, you know, we're not yelling at each other when you come down and took down a tree that we thought was going to stay.
So I think you can write in there that we will provide a, you know, arborist
landscape plan or
opinion
whatever, yeah,
as to what can go and what can stay.
You want something more detailed than that? I mean, that's really what
it
comes down to.
No, as long as there's an awareness that there are a number of trees, and the pictures show that from the aerial perspective, there are a number of trees that are right on the property line, some of them growing through chain link fences, as I understand. Some of them are well over 100 feet, and the concern is, certainly from some of the abutters on Green Street, that they continue to have shade trees because they do offer a noise buffer, they do help in terms of pollution, and they are certainly, from the ecology, the reason to keep them.
Is there a tree anywhere in the line where the easement for the drainage has to be?
Yes. It is.
You mean bordering, so like right here?
To the left, the easement is sort of all the way to the left of the patio issue. And there's two nice,
I know. So potentially, though, because of having to maintain that easement, the construction around that thing might be complicated. I don't know.
What I would just suggest is we'll bring an arborist to check it out. Help us. We've done that before.
So going back to the veranda, is that what we're calling it?
Terrace.
I'm sorry.
We call it courtyard on our plans.
The good thing from the neighbor's perspective is that sort of that line of sight, it will be cut off because of that wall, which also means the noise will be cut off because of that wall. I'm assuming that, I should just ask, what's the, what kind of building material is on the outside in there, in that area? No, along, on the walls.
It's a fiber cement panel.
All right.
Siding.
A hardy plank.
Hardy plank.
Fiber, traditional.
So as there's more of a residential palette on the rear of the building.
All right. I just want to make sure, because if it's harder, if it's something that's more reflective, sound reflective than that, then it will be really, it will bounce around and go right back into their backyards. But I think that hardy plank should be fine, especially with the. Like clapboard,
I think Pamela's point about the sound attenuation that plantings can provide. We are also proposing this line of planted buffer between the two, and those can be species that are also fuller that provide as much sound attenuation as possible.
It doesn't have to be arborvitaes; it can be many different things. I know that looks very endless.
I don't know.
May I? Before you go, can I just find out where we stand in this process? Where do we stand for schedule?
You're asking me?
Are we looking to get a decision tonight?
I think the applicant would like a decision tonight, but that's up to you guys.
I guess I still think that the above. A little bit of work to do on the parking layout.
Can I make a suggestion?
Sure.
We will. I'm pretty confident. I worked on it today. The reason why the compact spaces were there because it was so quickly done. But I'm pretty confident that we're going to be able to get the 69 spaces and the allowable compact spaces that we probably should set in terms of the smart growth standards, with for the percentage of compact spaces allowed.
Can you get to
I just don't want to go back and just for that, because I'm pretty confident we can achieve that.
Can you get to 65 spaces? Can you get to 65 real spaces and 52 units? That's 125.
65 without any compact spaces?
No, no.
Okay.
I'm suggesting that you make the compact spaces 8 feet wide like they're supposed to be. You're going to lose 4 spaces. So from 69, you're down to 65.
No, I think what he said was he's confident he can get the 65 spaces, reduce the number of compact spaces down to that 30 to 35% of the total. Is that?
Yeah, pretty confident.
No, I'm telling you what I'm thinking.
Yeah.
And well, that's what I think that you are saying the same thing.
No, I want to see. I'd like to see real size compact spaces down to a decent percentage, which I think brings you down to around 64, 65 spaces. And 1.25 for that is 52 units.
8 feet wide? Or?
I think the majority of them should be. I mean, maybe one, you know, there's like a, maybe one that's tucked into a corner or something. Park your motorcycle there.
So, Nick, can I just respectfully suggest a spin on that, which is we'll do 1.25. We'll be mandated to, so don't grant us a waiver for 1.25. Require that we hit the compact threshold, whatever that is, and the number of units that we end up getting, I would say no more than 55, in addition to that, no more than 55 units. Because we do need to go back. I mean, our sense is, you know, we will work on this. This is certainly not the last time that everyone's going to be. But to hold this up for that tweak.
I know it sounds minor, but I'm sketching on these plans, and that negative 3 units can chop away some of these corners on the upper floor. Changes the mix a little bit. That's just what I'm thinking.
I happen to agree with Nick, and I think this is a good plan, and I commend you guys for everything you've done so far. But I think if we could set that back a little bit, it would help the parking. And no offense to you guys, but the fact that this looks just like the model in Cambridge really bugs me. I come home from Cambridge every day for a reason. If we could maybe soften it or tweak it or do something to it.
Yeah, I think we also need to address the aesthetic issues, not necessarily the materials. I think it needs to look a little bit more of what we appreciate in Reading as far as the architecture and the look and feel. And I think a lot of those elements need to be injected in this project, which include things like corbels, wrought iron.
We're not building a turn-of-the-century building here. And every historic building that was ever built was built of its time.
Very true. However, the look and feel of Reading, people love for a certain reason, and that isn't it.
It's hard to get into a discussion of aesthetics, and not aesthetics, but a matter of opinion, right? Because when we start putting wrought iron on buildings, they start looking, like you said, like it could be Victorian, it could be, and some people like it, some people don't. We follow the design guidelines.
I just did a building in New Bedford's historic district, and their guidelines strictly prohibit you from replicating historic buildings. You can reference, you make reference by material, maybe a detail here or two.
Perhaps
I think
an homage to it is sufficient.
And I think they've done a pretty good job with that.
I'm with Nick's previous statement that I think that this corner, is the corner that we all are seeing in this rendering is, I get what you're doing, but I think it ends up being a little bit just too bold, too square and too blocky, that creates a, just a little, just sort of a, it goes into that non-Reading, not Reading feel to it. I have no idea what you do to that. I don't want to pretend like I do, but I think from my perspective, that's the piece. It's just a little bit too, you know, because it's tall, it's blocky, it's square. I like the brick and the sandstone and the articulation and everything. It's just that corner, I think.
So I think if you're suggesting 52 units in the compact space reduction, 1.25, it sounds like you're suggesting sort of a setback on the fourth floor on the Green Street facade. That's the feedback that I'm...
That's where I was sort of focusing, but if that allows you to shade, you know, to do something with this corner, then perhaps you put some of it there.
Okay. So we set that back.
We can do something
with that. Yeah, we can. I think that's not a difficult one to
come up with some alternatives.
I think the argument for the strong corner was that it presents a certain facing character to the building, to the public square, and that it allows it to be in dialogue with the other buildings that are in that town square. And, you know, and so I think that's where that idea is coming from. Obviously, it doesn't kill the, you know, scheme to, you know, soften that corner if you have to. But again, you know, there's also something to be said about the urban presence of the building and, you know, whether it is able to have that same character if we begin to chop away parts of it and no longer has a clear identity as it's addressing the town square.
And I do think at one point we did have that setback, and it started to blend into the entire building, and by doing that it breaks up, that's my opinion, it breaks up the building a lot more.
Okay.
We can definitely take a look at it.
We still have an open public comment. Open public hearing, right?
I believe so.
So, are there any more comments? Anything new? Okay.
My comment is just the two gentlemen in the back that said that the town meeting voted unanimously for the business bill.
I don't believe he said. I never said unanimous.
You didn't say unit overwhelmingly. There was a big work.
A town meeting.
But I bet if you polled the town meeting members and asked them if they were voting for that, if that's what they had in mind when they are voting, they would, most of them would say no, not that big structure. And my husband is on town meeting, and I showed him this picture, and I drove him by the site, and he was appalled at how enormous it was. And we're already very unhappy with the 30 Haven Street building, which, you know, is old news at this point, and that postmark is also awful.
Postmark's not this one, but understand.
No, I know, but just, okay. And I don't think that all town meeting members knew that they were voting for that.
Well, then town meeting members should get prepared. It's one of the things that's always annoyed me as a town meeting member, former town meeting member. People would come there and ask questions, obviously, that they weren't prepared. You know, that's your duty when you're town meeting members to read that warrant and get informed and go to the public hearing. So that's not an excuse.
Yeah, but
Wade, I'm sorry.
I feel like it was sort of...
Wade, Laura, I can understand and appreciate all the talk about the building, but I'm still talking about the volume. The 60 units, 55 units. And maybe it's me. Maybe I just don't understand, but... When I read 20 units per acre,
Minimum.
But, so I guess maybe that's where I'm wrong, but, you know, and as the town needs money, you know, the town forever, since I've been here for 25 years, we've not allowed business and commercial to capture that revenue that you've been talking about. How long did it take to get Home Depot and Jordan's in here? This project isn't going to save our problems. Haven Street isn't going to save our problems. This project is too big. There's too many units. And as a resident, I cannot believe that we're actually talking about a project this big in this size lot. This isn't Somerville and Cambridge, which that building would fit in perfectly. This is Reading. I came here because it was a small town, and now we want to make downtown a downtown? It doesn't make any sense to me. And
I do have one more question you can ponder. If you got rid of the retail, could you put all 52 units on three floors?
Ground level units?
I don't know what you'd use it for. I don't know how you'd do it.
They have ground level units in the Melrose ones.
It wouldn't necessarily be ground level units. It would just be...
Jonathan, is it?
Thank you, Nick. I'll be quick. I know you want to wrap this up. Just a quick comment. I said this at the last meeting. I am a town meeting member. I said at the last meeting I opposed the extension of the downtown Small Grove District to this area, and I specifically asked whether or not consideration had been given to the number of residents who were in this new area and whether or not there had been any discussions or consideration to them. So just to be clear for the record, at least one person opposed it. There have been other things that I've opposed the town meeting member that has not, I did not get a lot of support of, so I'm not surprised. But that's not my question. I'm now putting on my historical commission hat. We submitted letters to the CPDC, and which I believe also Dave, the developer, seen. I just want to bring your attention to some of those comments. We had asked, actually, we were the ones that asked that a scale model be ultimately made and presented so that people can get a better idea about this. We had suggested that it be a requirement of the CPDC, so I'm just raising that for your attention. We also had raised two other points to the developer through the CPDC. One was not just to mimic, and maybe that's the best that can be done, but we wanted the developer to consider incorporating actual elements of the original historic building. Just want to throw that out there for consideration of CPDC or for the developer. And lastly, I know that, Dave, that you have incorporated that public meeting room, which is wonderful. We had talked a lot about the historical aspect of this, and we had talked, and in our letter we had said that we would like there to be a well-designed interpretive exhibit in the new building somewhere. We were interpreting that that would be in that public space. There's information about that in our letter. We just wanted to bring that to the attention of CPDC and to you. I don't know where or how that gets factored in. It would obviously be something we'd be discussing in terms of demolition delay, but I have a feeling that's going to be so far down the road that a lot of this is going to be already determined. So I just want to bring that up for your attention. Thank you.
Thanks. It's late. Are we going to push this off here? Are we going to vote? I really would like to know if we can get down to 52 units. And
I guess.
Those corners.
I guess I don't feel comfortable voting on the. I mean that. Yeah. Without seeing some of that.
I'm sorry, I have to object to that. I think that the retail is actually an essential element to revitalizing downtown. I think that not only the residents, but having another building to activate almost turns it into a triangle between the corner with the hitching post and somebody at Zynga to this creates a zone that I think would actually revitalize downtown, whereas everything's been in fits and starts before. So I think taking the retail out may not accomplish some of the economic development goals that we're aiming for with this project.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
I understand.
Mm-hmm.
I just think that that's to be considered.
We also have a retailer that's really interested in being there, to be honest. And I agree wholeheartedly in terms of just...
Okay. All right. No close the public hearing, just continue.
Move that we continue the public hearing for the Downtown Smart Growth Plan Review for 2024 Boole Street until What time?
November 6th at 9 o'clock.
November 6th, Monday.
Can we all buy an earlier song?
No, we already.
Ben, I think we have a.
We can all agree on that.
Public hearing scheduled before that, so. This is my life right now. Sorry.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, okay.
Did we second it and vote?
Yeah, all in favor? You don't?
I don't vote. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
It's already the next day.
How you doing?
I'm good, how you doing? Yeah.
How are you doing?
Good, how are you?